and it's about to get deaf because Doug Scott's among the nation's best. Grambling State representing the West, while the beast of the East, the Dogs of A&M, SWAC Championships where they playing them. So get ready for a rise in intensity right before your eyes on BET. Today from Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama, it's the battle for conference supremacy as the Grambling State Tigers, champs of the West, take on the East champs, Alabama A&M. Hello, everybody. I'm George Johnson. You know, when the regular season began, there was talk that Grambling State and Alabama A&M would make some noise in their respective divisions. Well, when the dust had settled, both teams had done what it takes to get to the biggest game of the season, and that's the SWAC Championship game being played today live on BET. Let's take a look at the way the standings ended up. Alabama A&M and Alabama State finished tied at 5-2, but they played each other in the Magic City Classic, seen here on BET. A&M won, that gave them the berth. On the West side, it's been all Grambling State, 6-1 in conference play. Their only loss this season coming last week at the Bayou Classic at the hands of Southern University. Joining us in the booth is the former Black College Player of the Year from Howard University, Jay Walker. And when you talk about Grambling State, this is a club that won 8 straight ball games, seen as the number one team in all of Black college football. They've continued to mature week in and week out, and so has their quarterback, Randy Hines.
Yes, and Randy Hines has had to mature, not only as a quarterback, like all young quarterbacks must, but playing the most pressurized position in Black college football, and that's being a quarterback underneath a Doug Williams coach team. At times, he's played exceptional. At other times, his maturity is lacked, meaning the 3 interceptions against Southern University in the biggest game of the year for them. On the defensive side of the football, they're led by Robert Taylor. Robert Taylor is a homeboy coming back to Birmingham, Alabama, playing in this final college football game, coming off of an all-SWAC year. He's led the Grambling State defense with 192 tackles, playing football phenomenal. He's going to need about 10 or 15 more today in order for his team to be successful and capture Coach Williams' first SWAC championship.
Also in the booth with us is the former All-Pro offensive guard of the Dallas Cowboys, Nate Newton. For the Alabama A&M Bulldogs, it's been a little different ride. They've had to battle their way in. Case in point, last week, they had the win against Arkansas Pine Bluff. They did. That is what gave them the berth to this championship ball game. As they continue to develop, so has their quarterback, Kelvin Robinson.
Kelvin Robinson's a tough guy. He lost his job early in the season during the Grambling game with a costly interception, only to come back against Marsh Brown and do his job. Today he faces Grambling again, and he's out to prove that he can do the job. On the other side of the ball is Jamal Ware, number 2. He played outside linebacker, but they moved him inside. Coach Thompson, defense coordinator, said with that move inside, the defense has really blossomed, and they're number 1 first to run at 40 yards per game.
You talk about Jamal Ware moving from the outside to the inside. We move from inside to outside, and when we do that, that means we're going down to the field and hearing from Joe Claire. What's going on, Joe?
Check this out. It's your man, Joe Claire. It's the SWAC Championship, and we are still angry because they stole the election. So I'm going to be off the hook today. It's George Bush's fault if something happened. You see the spit coming out and everything? That's how it's going to be the whole game. Back up to y'all upstairs. Oh, yeah. What happened to the national anthem? I think you took a word out of something.
All right. Thank you very much, Joe. Well, you've got two coaches in this football game. Both began with their football teams 3 years ago. Doug Williams has turned this program into a champion, but so has Ron Cooper at Alabama A&M. The winner of this football game will be seen as the coach of the year in the SWAC. They'll settle things on the field next here on BET. Today's Black College Football Classic is brought to you by Southwest Airlines. Southwest Airlines brings freedom to the net with affordable fares and frequent flights. Log on for low fares at www.southwest.com. Southwest Airlines, a symbol of e-freedom. And by TiVo, TV your way. And by Western Union Money Transfer, the fastest way to send money worldwide.
All week, for all 2 weeks, basically. We know what he can do, but we have a great corner in Brandon Reed. We're going to line him up on him man on man. And I think Brandon Reed, Scotty Anderson, I put my money on Brandon Reed.
That was Eric Chappelle, of Alabama A&M, talking about that man on the right, Brandon Reed, a first-team all-SWAC selection who led the conference in interceptions, going head-to-head with Grambling State's all-time leading receiver in Scotty Anderson.
Scotty Anderson's a tough guy. He's a great receiver, man, but Brandon Reed is a young guy. He's confident. He plays within himself, and this is going to be a super matchup.
Back deep to receive the kick, Kenyon Hambrick, who has been outstanding. Kickoff returns averaging 21 yards per return. His longest return of the season, 48 yards. But this one will never get to him. It was fielded on the 23-yard line and turned about, let's say, 7, 8 yards, where the Bulldogs will take over first and 10 at the 33. So starting things off, Alabama A&M on offense, and they're led by the senior quarterback from Mobile, Alabama, Calvin Robinson, who has completed 45% of his passes, thrown for over 1,100 yards this year, averaging 138 yards per game. Harvin Strong is his running back, and Curtis Darnell is a second-team All-SWAC selection. You see Kenyon Hambrick and Torrey Day at the wide receiver spots. First and 10 for the Bulldogs, who come in at 7-4. And do we have a timeout already on the field? Let's take a look at the rest of the starting lineup for Alabama A&M. I guess the timeout was worth it to us because we get to finish our starting lineup. Kendrick Rogers is first team all SWAC, and they say he's on his way to the next level. Chance Turner has also been getting a look. Emerson Woodard and Ron Wilson, who they say is just plain old nasty on that right tackle spot.
Those big nasty get you going there. Alabama A&M having to start off the game with a tight timeout. Not the way you want to start the SWAC Championship game. Coach Cooper just wants to make sure, though, they come out right. First possession can mean a whole lot in terms of a football game at this magnitude.
Mills never ran on the field.
Meanwhile, we talk a lot about how Alabama A&M has the best defense, especially against the run in the conference. But when you talk about Grambling State, they're the second best defense in the conference. We'll look at them in a second. First and 10 for Robinson. He fakes the handoff inside, gets it to Hambrick, and Hambrick is forced out of bounds. Coming up to make the play, Byron Addison, number 6. Let's take a look at the defense for the Grambling State Tigers. Lawrence, Willie Gray, who may be the key for this defensive line. Your linebackers, the top three tacklers on the team, Robert Taylor, has definitely been coming at folks. Addison, Pearson, Marlon Williams, and Calvin Spears, your defensive secondary. Today's starting line brought to you by Western Union Money Transfer, the fastest way to send money worldwide. Second down and 6 to go. Here is the tailback, Curtis Darnell, and a great defensive play by big Robert Taylor, the senior who, as Jay said, has come back home to perform in front of the folks.
And playing here in this game, he's got to be ready to mix it up. You know, we noted early in the game, A&M's not going to try and beat you too much by the pass. They're going to come right at you, give you a little bit of trickery, and make you beat them stopping the run.
And you can definitely watch the left side of this offensive line and Kendrick Rogers and Chance Turner. They've been doing a great job, and they're going to continue to try to punish them off the left side there.
They're probably going to have to go back and pass formation with it being third down now and 8. Robinson, he's got good protection, but he made the wrong decision maybe to try to run up the middle, and Willie Gray puts the clamps on it.
And talking to the defensive line coach, Coach Scott for the Grambling State Tigers, he said Willie Gray is his quickest player. His first step is tremendous. They look for a lot of things out of the sophomore player here, 6 foot, 300-pound player.
So now, forced to punt, Alabama A&M, Travis Shug will be the man to kick. Levi Washington is standing back at his 24-yard line. Fields it at the 22, and a great play by Alabama A&M. Coming up to make that tackle was Brian Johnson, who has done an unbelievable job in the secondary this year, put together some pretty good numbers.
When you look at a defensive game like this, where you ranked 1 and 2, a lot of things can happen. But a lot of times the offense will sneak up and do a super job because they're looking to get overshadowed here. But, you know, when you got a Scottie Anderson out wide, a lot of things can happen.
So here comes the Grambling State Tigers, 9-2 on the season, 6-1 in conference play. Hines is your quarterback. And he's going to his backfield and hands it off to Brad Hill, the sophomore, averaging 4.1 yards per carry. Now let's take a look at the starting lineup for Grambling State, brought to you by Western Union Money Transfer, the fastest way to send money worldwide. Where Rodney Boot Juan is your fullback. Michael Young, your tailback. Scott Anderson has been unbelievable, but Ellis Spears has developed into a pretty good wide receiver. As you take a look at the two-sport player in Randy Himes, actually a three-sport player. He plays basketball at Grambling State, also runs track. Gives the football to Brad Hill, and on second down and 7, he is stopped at the line of scrimmage. Let's go back to our Western Union starting lineups, where the offensive line is a very good one. Larry Mativia is your center, who came here with Doug Williams from Morehouse. Frank Livingston, who got shaken up a little bit last week against Southern, is back at the left tackle spot. And there is Doug Williams in his third season here at Grambling, a graduate of Grambling. His record is 21-12 in 3 years at the school. Third down now in 7. Randy put all sorts of time and overthrows his intended receiver, Levi Washington, but there's a flag on the field down at about the 46-yard line. And it looks like that's where interference would be called back there.
Probably so. You get a flag thrown that deep in the secondary, some type of bumping that was taking place downfield that shouldn't have happened. Interesting to see what Coach Williams is going to do here in terms of how do you stop Alabama A&M on defense. They're a team that likes to blitz the quarterback a whole lot. And Doug, being a former quarterback himself, is going to do some things to protect his quarterback. We saw there in the very first pass play of the game.
The pass was uncatchable. Fourth down.
Well, to follow up on what you just said, you remember against Louisville earlier this year, Doug said that's when he found out that he was going to go with Randy Himes as opposed to Micah Mays, because Himes got sacked 10 times by Louisville in that ball game, and every time he picked himself up off the turf and came back strong.
He said he likes his toughness. That's the one thing he said describing Randy. He said he's just a tough kid.
Yeah, and Marshall Hayes, the offensive line coach, said he went in there and reviewed the films too and found out ways to stop that blitz, because his offensive line didn't look too well that game.
Richmond punting. Neil Lindsay is back to receive the punt. And it's never going to get to him as it bounces out of bounds at about the 43-yard line. Again, our starting lineup brought to you by Western Union Money Transfer, the fastest way to send money. Oh my. To Birmingham, Alabama, where the Bulldogs in their second possession and immediately going to their tailback, Curtis Darnell, the junior from Mobile, second team all-conference selection, the team's top rusher, averaging 3.7 yards per carry. He picked up 5 on that play.
And what a block they're giving by the wide receiver, Mr. Airness himself, Michael Jordan. As you see the pitch here from Kelvin Robinson, Michael Jordan playing here in his hometown will come wipe out the Grambling defender, which you can't get to take a look at here. What a great block. Michael Jordan's real excited to be playing back home in Birmingham, Alabama for his final game.
Jordan caught the winning pass in the Magic City Classic last year. And this time, they tried the quick pass to Neil Lindsay, the sophomore from Birmingham, who's also looking to have a big game. And unfortunately, he stopped very quickly by your defensive back, Byron Addison. Second tackle for Addison already. Take a look at the series between these two teams. And Grambling State leads at 5-2. Keep in mind, Alabama A&M just joined the SWAC 3 years ago. Were eligible for the title just 2 years ago. And they jumped to the SWAC from the SIAC.
Trying to get in a better league, baby.
And they are here. Third down situation. Boy, that was a dangerous play defensively for the Grambling State Tigers. Antoine Lawrence was there to break things up.
Got Alabama A&M doing a couple things they really don't feel comfortable doing right now. They're trying to trick Grambling with all these weird formations, just throwing little short passes. So obviously they're trying to cover up for what they feel is a weakness in the passing game. And probably Calvin Spears has a lot to do with that as well. We want to stay away from him and not let him be a cheerleader.
So Travis Shug will come in and punt. You see his average 36 yards per punt, his longest this season, 63. Washington takes this one at the 22-yard line, getting to the outside, returns it 10 yards. That a punt of 32 yards by Shug. So looks like we have another flag on the field. Keep in mind, these two teams have been known to put some penalties, 18 penalties between the two of the first teams.
Well, you know, the SWAC has such fine officiating. They do their job. Nothing gets over on these SWAC officials. They're going to call everything out there. You'll see
officials.
Are you, running
they
for office?
He's head of SWAC officials. We actually had two penalties on that play there. Look, we had an illegal procedure and a personal foul.
There's Cooper, an 82 graduate of Jacksonville State.
All year now.
We win
a championship game in front of TV.
He's going into politics.
Our conference looks like an idiot because everybody's around looking at us saying, everybody bends the thing. We've been doing it all year.
Of course, we get a chance to hear from the head coach, Ron Cooper, and there's Doug. And I'm sure Doug doesn't want us to hear anything he has to say.
We should send Ron down there to Florida to straighten out this political mess.
Doug said, keep the microphones away from us. Cooper pleading this case here, too. This is a big game. They're playing on national TV. This helps. Okay, they're playing Alabama A&M. This is almost like a home game for them on a neutral site, but we are in the state of Alabama. He knows the importance of this game, and he doesn't want to let the stripes, as the former players like to call them, the stripes take it away from his team.
Against the kicking team, that penalty declined. I got a dead ball foul, late hit, in the teaching area, 15 yards against the kicking team, first down.
Well, Coach was probably saying, hey, listen, we are hyped up for this football game. Sometimes I would assume kids get a little overzealous. Those late hits come up just because you're very excited.
One word is adrenaline. Adrenaline gets the flowing in you. It's hard to get it out of you.
Last time these two teams met, Alabama A&M had the lead throughout the football game. They led 14-3. Then in the third quarter, Grambling first gets an interception that Nate talked about from Robert Taylor on Robinson's 63-yard return. That made it 17-10. Then Scotty Anderson caught a 20-yard touchdown pass with 2.5 minutes remaining to give the Tigers the victory. Here they are, first down, looking downfield. Anderson makes the catch. We just talked about him. And boy, what a big play right there as he makes the catch inside the 10-yard line. Takes it down to the 7.
You said that was going to be a key matchup there. Alabama A&M, they want to blitz, play man-to-man coverage. Doug says, I'll take my best receiver, Scotty Anderson, probably my best player, and get a matchup problem where I can get him lined up against your best defender, Brandon Reed. We talked about where the money is, but right now it looks like Eric Chappelle could be out of some money if it continues to go this way all game. Great job of concentrating there, focusing on the football. Reed just kind of ill-timed his jump. Quarterback underthrew the ball a little bit, but a great receiver can make a good quarterback look better.
And Randy Hines threw that out under a little bit of pressure from Alabama's defense.
64th catch of the season for Scotty Anderson, and immediately the Tigers capitalize on the big play by Anderson by going to Ellis Spears for the short touchdown play. 7-yard touchdown pass from Randy Hines to Ellis Spears. Spears' fourth touchdown reception of the season.
And Coach Williams was very high on Ellis Spears. Remember talking to him yesterday. He said that Ellis Spears is going to be a player you got to watch out for. I love the way he plays. He can do everything. You see there, he does a good job of getting big when the ball was on its way, putting himself between the ball and the cornerback.
And when you're dealing with an Ellis Spears who's taking advantage of opportunities that Scottie Pippen's awarded him, it's just outstanding.
So once again, this young man, Randy Himes, going to Ellis Spears. And the Tigers, a little pumped, and why not? They take the early lead in this SWAC championship game with a short touchdown pass from Himes to Spears. We're back here in Birmingham, George Johnson along with Jay Walker, Nathan, and Joe Claire as Amprick on the kickoff return is upended very quickly before he could gather any steam whatsoever by Brian Anderson.
Anderson there did a good job of playing great special teams, getting to the defender. In a game like this, what people forget about, the magnitude of the game can be affected by the special teams play here.
Guys are going to be pumped. Young guys are getting to play the special teams. You want them young kamikaze guys flying around. It don't have anything to do but play special teams and make big plays.
No players in the backfield for Robinson on first and 10. And this time, very quickly throws it out into the flat to his receiver. That was Dondra Hope.
Probably what they did is they motioned Curtis Donnell out there, trying to figure out different ways to try and get him the football. Don't want to run directly at Graham because Grambling has a great run and stop defense. What they do is by formation, get Curtis Donnell out there in the flat. It's almost like a long handoff, an extended handoff.
It doesn't make a difference to Robert Taylor because he was out there on the tackle regardless.
From his middle linebacker spot.
So that shows you the range that he have as a player.
Absolutely. Picked up 6 yards on that play. Get it second down. Eric Moore is our stat man, and he looks at me and says that was a 5-yard play. As George Guidry, linebacker, comes up and makes the play right here, and the Bulldogs lose yards on that play. Take a look at our scoring drive. It took just 2 plays for the Tigers to hit the Bulldogs. You had the big touch, the big play to Scotty Anderson, and they follow that up with the quick slant in to Ellis Spears.
Right here, they turn around and pitching it to Parham. And he's trying to turn up. They're trying to attack this left side. But as you say, Guidry didn't let nothing happen out there. He's right up on top of the plate.
You see how big Corey Parham is, but
it goes to say
that he was a linebacker.
Breaking the huddle with 12 men, 5-yard penalty, replay.
So the Bulldogs, despite getting the big play and first down now, moving themselves all the way back to the initial line of scrimmage with that penalty.
But when we talk about
Parham, they moved him from running back to linebacker. He bulked up, became a pretty good linebacker.
Right.
Now he's back at fullback right now. Are they going to make their mind up, Nate, about what they want to do?
Well, Coach Cooper said that he had to put somebody over to try to pound this Grambling's defense, so this is the guy for him. Parham, when you want to see some power, he's the guy to get up in the middle.
Third down and 11. Pass was intended for Hamprick. Good defensive coverage for the Grambling State Tigers. That was Byron Addison, the senior who's been on several plays already here early on in the ballgame. 8-11 left here in our first quarter. And now the Bulldogs will be forced to punt the football back to Grambling State.
You can look for the seniors to play lights out and try to make things happen because they're going out. They want to go out on top. They want to make things happen. So the seniors, you can look for them to be trying to make plays all day to be remembered by.
Shug will punt the football back to Washington. Looked like he was going to wave for a second for the fair catch, and he did. He was hoping maybe they didn't see me.
But we saw you.
So it's down at the 40-yard line. We'll be first and 10. The pageantry that is black college football here in Birmingham. We have more for you next.
The pageantry.
The Tigers, who got off to a 9-1 start, best since 1994, have a 7-0 lead, and the football here in our second annual Southwest Airlines SWAC Championship game.
Jamal Ware just came loose right up the middle, put pressure on your quarterback, made a nice play.
You can see Randy Himes' numbers, 4th in the conference in passing, and against Alabama A&M on the 16th, a game in which they came back and won. He threw the football 49 times, completing 24, but threw for 289 yards. That's a new thing today, fellas, is throw the football often.
Long and often.
And here's Himes throwing long and often, looking for his receiver.
Oh, what a play.
Makes a catch, still on his feet, touchdown.
Ellis Spears
go
all the way back.
Reception. His 2nd of the ball game, 5th of the season.
And what a throw was there by the quarterback, Randy Himes. We said he had to mature as a quarterback. He showed maturity and poise there in the pocket because he took a blow in order to get that pass off. A team like Alabama A&M, it's going to blitz you a whole lot. You're going to have some maturity, hit him with the long bomb. Great route here. The wide receiver saved plenty of sideline for his quarterback to throw the ball to. And then he gets one a little bit more there. Ellis Spears made a good play. He's got a lot of size. He's 6'3", 180 pounds. Plus, he's a high jumper in high school as well.
And the quarterback took a lot of heat from Fuqua, 43 Fuqua, before he released that ball.
The official said that he stepped out of bounds at the 12-yard line. So now Grambling State, after the 48-yard play, have 1st and 10, and Himes had no one to throw the football to and is forced out of bounds near the line of scrimmage. And I don't know if we have the shot. Let's take a look and see if he did go out of bounds. Let's take a look.
Great call.
Great call. SWAC officiating. I talked about them earlier. They're right on cue.
Absolutely. Foot hit the line. That right foot. He tried to regain his balance. Reggie Johnson was the defender back there. And Johnson has moved from second string to first string just a couple of weeks ago over Brian Johnson. And you know they're going to pick on that redshirt freshman. He too, talking about Reggie Johnson, number four, is from Birmingham. Second down situation for the Tigers. Hines is going to throw the football into the end zone and through the end zone. His receiver cut inside and spears, and I thought maybe he was taking an out pattern.
Yeah, but on that last play, they had him bracketed. They had him bracketed. They had him DB underneath and one over the top. So if he wouldn't have went in or out, he was already covered.
Let's go on down to the field, Joe Claire.
Check this out, y'all. I'm standing here with Miss Kelly Butler. Miss Grambling, what, 2000? Miss Grambling, and where are you from?
I'm from Grambling, Louisiana.
So she's from Grambling and she Miss Grambling. I think it's some Bush stuff going on, really, at Grambling. How you just gonna be from Grambling and you Miss Grambling? All right, I'm just messing with y'all. I'm just messing. You want to, real quick, who's these
people? These are the ladies that make up the corps. This is Miss Freshman Nancy Cook. This is Miss Junior Rashonda Tatum. Miss Senior Kim Smith. And Miss Sophomore Zanetta Silver.
All right, so you see that the black college has a tradition of having beautiful sisters and brothers representing them. Back up to y'all up top. I'm just down here. Happy being black.
Hey, Joe. Can you hear me down there?
I guess you lost, Joe.
I can't hear none of y'all. Nothing y'all saying up top.
He says, I can't hear you.
Or maybe
he's
I don't want to hear you.
5 miles away. Let's get a commercial break. When we come back, we'll have more of the SWAC Championship here in Birmingham. Welcome back. As the Grambling State Tiger fans are happy about the fact that their club is knocking on the door again, already with a 7-0 lead here on third down. Hines got rid of it. Great pressure by the Bulldogs. Jay Walker talked about the fact that they like to blitz you. They like to come at you. Got this one off to Spears, but Spears may have lost 2 yards on that play, and it causes a fourth down situation.
Right here you see players coming free. That's Jamal Ware, who we spoke of earlier, right up the middle. You will see him all day coming from every angle, inside, outside. But it's going to be hard to shake Mr. Hines because, as you said before, he's been hit numerous times before.
Minus 2 yards on that play, so a 32-yard attempt by Lawrence Richmond, and it is no good. So Richmond now 6 of 12 on the season, came in 6 of 11 in field goals, 54%, but misses that one from 32 yards out. And so we stay at 7-0 with 6:55 left here in the first quarter. We talked about Grambling State when we were in commercial break and the fact that they're throwing the ball and throwing it often. But you cannot run against this Bulldog, a defense that has only given up 44 yards a game, can you?
Yeah. Every now and then you have to, just because. You don't want them to know you're going to pass, but then they're going to tee off on your quarterback all day long. You don't want that.
Meanwhile, the Bulldogs have no problem keeping it on the ground as they give it to Corey Parham, the former linebacker.
And he hits right off the right side behind Jonathan Woodward and the center there, Brandon Emerson. But it's a flag here.
And the Bulldogs have had some penalties already here in the first quarter that have hurt them.
Illegal shift on the offense, 5-yard penalty, replay first down.
Back to what we was talking about earlier, whereas Grambling does have to do some type of a running game, because if you become one-dimensional, then you're easier to defend. So I agree with you, Jay. They have to find some type of running game.
That's the third penalty for A&M in this early part of the game, 26 yards. Robinson will pass the football. Pretty good protection as he decides to hold on to it. Takes it back out to the initial line of scrimmage, the 20-yard line. Robinson, he's the transfer from Central Florida, played 2 years at junior college, and Jay, as a former quarterback yourself, that means that he has played for 4 different coaches in 3 years. Tough to really get, you know, acclimated, to feel comfortable when you got all these different things coming your way.
Especially so, you know, I'm pretty much on the impression that he was a running quarterback coming out of high school. And then coming to A&M, he went through the same thing where they ran a pure option for many years. Now they try to put a little bit of a passing game in. And it's kind of hard to get used to it because you got to get on the same page with your offensive coordinator, make sure you guys are trying to get the same things accomplished.
The tight end, Matt Cruz, went in motion on that play and got in Robinson's way, and that may have thrown off the timing when it came to handing it off to Parham. Parham picks up maybe a yard on the play. That'll make it third down. Third down conversions for Alabama A&M, just 25%. But in this ball game, they are now 0-3 in that department. Got a power, big old, that big eye right there with three backs, but they put a man in motion, and here comes Robinson on the rollout. Was this a design to run the football?
It was a design to roll out to the right, and Grambling's just all over.
Coming up to make the play for Grambling was the linebacker, Terrence Dukes, number 8. But we've got another flag on the field. And the Tigers are pointing the Bulldogs' way.
Robinson there just cut back in the grain, trying to make a play here. Design rollout all the way, as Nate alluded to. They just didn't fool them at all. Things like that, they're trying to get some different ways. You can't run directly at the Grambling defense because they're number 2 in the rush defense as well. So you got to try and beat them to the corner and make them think you're going to pass when you hit them with a run.
And those linebackers of Taylor, Guidry, and Dukes are very hard to beat. They are 1, 2, and 3 in tackling. So if you want to run the football against the Tigers, you better be wary of their 3 linebackers. As Shug will kick it off, Washington unable to hold on to it, but is able to get the kind bounce and get possession of the football. Great coverage for Alabama A&M led by Taurus Blackburn.
That's scary there. In a game like this, like I said before, they're going to need a whole lot of great special teams play here. He's trying to make something play in a big game. Took his eye off it for 1 second. Did a great job on the recovery of the football. But that Alabama and A&M special teams unit is swarming all over the football. And I think with an offense that's not expected to put up a lot of points, Coach Cooper really feels that his team may be able to win this game or take this game on special teams.
32-yard punt, 2-yard return for Washington, who last week we saw being taken off the field against Southern with a bad ankle sprain, and yet nothing could keep that player out of this football game. As on 1st and 10, the Tigers give it to Hill, and Brad picks up a couple of yards.
It was a mad swarm, the whole defense there. I was talking with Coach Cooper yesterday, and I said, Coach, how do you get these guys to understand? He said, Nate, I just sell it over and over. When we walk on the practice field, stop the run. When they leave off the practice field, stop the run. So these guys, when they sleepwalk, it's stop the run.
Well, they have stopped it. 44 yards a game they're giving up. That is number 1 in the country. And only twice this year have they allowed an opponent to rush for over 90 yards in a game. That was against Troy State and Alabama State. And on 2nd down and 9, Himes' pass is too high, and that'll make it 3rd down after the incompletion.
Once again, talk about a matchup with Brandon Reed and Scott Anderson. Brandon Reed is a young guy, and Scott is going to try to school him, who's the veteran player. But I was on the elevator with this young guy, Brandon Reed, and I was watching his demeanor. He's real poised, real cool. And over one thing he was proud and smiling about was that all-SWAC trophy he got, that conference trophy he got.
And he's got a chance to get 2 more because he's just a sophomore. 3rd down and 9 now, and Himes will go into the shotgun formation. Good pressure by the Bulldogs. Here they come. Himes on the run looking for Hill, and he couldn't make the catch. And now a late flag comes in as we've got some little taunting going on in the middle of the field.
But guess where the pressure was coming from, and guess who the pressure was coming from? Where? Where is he? Jamal Ware.
Number 2, Jamal is
dead ball foul.
The team's top tackler.
Second team, all SWAC.
We did a game with him early in the year. He just basically dominated that football game against Alabama State in the Magic City. That was the Magic City Classic. He was just dominating that game, and they didn't have an answer for him. And I think Coach Williams is going to have to hurry up and find one soon, or else Randy Himes is going to pay the price for it.
Well, the quick
personal foul against the offense, 4th down.
And when you talk about Ware, the question was, is he too little to play linebacker? But he has proven that he can. Meanwhile, how about the matchup for Scotty Anderson?
You see here Scotty getting off the ball. He has Brandon beat a little bit. You kind of want your quarterback. That's one of the things that'll frustrate Doug.
I don't know.
Richmond now punting the football. This one is going to bounce in front of Lindsey and eventually be down by Grambling State. Robert Butler is the man who put a hand on it. So Alabama A&M with pretty good field position on their third possession. That punt went 30 yards. It'll be first and 10 at the 45. With one with Jay Walker and Nate Newton with me up in the booth, and we got JC down on the field, Joe Claire.
Who is your son?
And we also have Jason on the field.
Who are you?
With the cheerleading squad.
Who are you?
Shorty G? Is that what you're going to get at?
No, sir.
First and 10 for Alabama A&M. And immediately going to the outside and picking up good yards is Neil Lindsay, the sophomore from
Birmingham, Alabama.
A lot of homeboys in this game.
A lot of homeboys. But as you notice there, they've ran only, I think, three times or even threw passes three times to the right side. They're going to that left side, which they really believe in. And Kendrick Rogers and Chance Turner, supposed to be some strong guys, veteran guys, that makes things happen.
He picked up 11 yards on that play, takes it into Tiger territory at the 44-yard line. Now they go inside the teeth of that Grambling State defense with their tailback, Curtis Donnell.
Well, you know, right here, coming off of Brandon Emerson and Chance Turner right up the middle, they're going to pound it because they know at any moment when Grambling has the ball, it can explode all over them. So they say, hey, we'll take control. We'll set the tempo and make some things happen.
3-yard pickup, third down and 7. Again, with that formation where they put, actually it's second down and 7, check that. And on the option, Donnell gets left out the drive, makes a nice move to try to get back to the initial line of scrimmage, but nothing doing. And we talked about the linebackers. There they are again. 54, Robert Taylor. Terrence Duke's number 8, the other linebacker back there.
Those guys there, they're what we just call in football. Those are just headhunters. Those linebackers, they just want to hit something. Hit somebody every play. Shedding the block there. You see Eric Chappell does a great job of getting there, making Donnell cut back against the grain. And if you cut back in, you don't want to cut back in to Mr. Taylor or Mr. Gidry, because those guys will knock your head off.
Oh, yes, they will.
They're pretty tough now. They like what you call raw bone players.
So here we go now, third down, and after a loss of 4, it's third down and 11, going deep, got a receiver. Can he make the catch? And nothing doing, but maybe we get a flag. No call inside the end zone. The pass was intended for Torrey Day, and back defensively was Calvin Spears, who is a 3-time All-SWAC selection.
You know what I like here? They attack Calvin Spears. This is a veteran play here that Spears made. He's clearly beat. If you see at the end of this replay, he's going to grab that inside hand of number 88 just to hold it, to slow up his stride, tangle him up a little bit, make him make that great one-handed catch that obviously that he couldn't do there. They were going for a home run play. He did a great job of recovering.
That's a great observation because Michael Irvin used to do that to defensive backs. You notice Chris?
The penalty declined, fourth down.
So it wouldn't have counted if you caught it anyway, if they're going to make a call.
But that's just great coaching there. For Calvin Spears to have the know-how to do that. They teach that once you get to the NFL 101 as a defensive back. He's got it already with him. 3 years all swag. I figured, you know, he would learn a little something like that.
You talk about Spears, number 4. He has a chance to become the first Grambling State Tiger to be named first team all swag for 4 years.
That would be a heck of an accomplishment with the talent that's come to that school.
Like a true man, John.
So they fake the punt. And inside they give it to Ware. And Ware on third down and 11. Maybe picked up 5 yards, so they'll turn it over on downs.
And we talked to Coach Cooper beforehand. Grambling knew it. We all knew that they're going to try a couple of trick plays somewhere in this game here.
10 yards.
We have a fake punt here. They've got tons of these. Fake. Watch the punt here. Act like the snap went over his head. He jumped up there for the play action.
They
went to Jamal, Mr. Everywhere. Grambling's not going to be fooling this game. If they would have, Coach Williams would go crazy because you know a team's going to come out with a lot of special team plays and trick plays. You coach them up extra hard that week.
Right, because when Doug already know that this, they don't have the offensive weapons to deal with his team, so he's going to expect some type of trickery.
Fun to watch, though. We love it. We love getting those type of trick plays, but not when they backfire against you.
And they backfired on them because that was 7 yards shy of a first down, so they turned it over on downs. First and 10 for Grambling State at the 41-yard line. Being pressured is Himes. Himes gets out of the pocket and turns a negativity into a positivity.
Maurice Carr with that pressure right up the gut. That was just a pure bull rush there by Maurice Carr. I mean, he's coming. As soon as Himes gets in the pocket, he's got to go. Big fella don't want to run, though. He's not going to catch Himes. Now, Himes is a three-sport athlete, but good pursuit, a way to keep going.
Yeah, he's running because he just got hit in the back, as you can see there. So the SWAC officials did miss one play.
He'll be sucking up some wind too. I don't think he'll be in the backfield this time. Big Cole don't like to run that far.
6-yard pickup for Himes. Makes second down and 4. This time he gives it to Hill, and Hill, nothing doing. Great play by the middle linebacker, Donnell Fisher, number 33. He was in the backfield to make the tackle.
That A&M defense, boy, it is tough to run against them, but you got to keep trying. You got to keep trying. It's almost like with a lottery ticket.
He goes back to he has to cut it back because there's nowhere to go. And Maurice Carr showed up again, breathing hard and heavy and everything, and made the tackle.
Carr is a senior from Nashville, as you get a look right there. Fisher, the third leading tackler on this football team. Fisher's from Albany, Georgia.
So we got a guy that's not from Birmingham. So the officials getting together saying, well, boy, we let Jay down.
So thanks to the good defensive play by Donnell Fisher, not from Birmingham. It's third down now in 5. Himes looking for the first down. Gets bumped a little bit. You do not want to hit a quarterback that close to the sideline, whether he can take it or not. You know, the officials, they start getting a little itchy with the flags.
Don't get me started.
We have an injured player out there, too.
We have an injured player, and we have a flag about 3 feet away from him.
I think it's big William Jackson, the sophomore right tackle, 6'6", 320. That's a lot of man spread out over that field.
Yeah, he got a little shoulder in there. Yeah. See Anderson trying to get off the bump. Brandon Reed there. He's holding on to him a little bit because Scott Anderson did a great job of losing him on the line of scrimmage. Wait for the football. Then Reed's going to comes up and hits the quarterback.
That is going to be a fun matchup to watch throughout the day. Those two great players going head to head. We watch William Jackson, the right tackle of the Grambling State Tigers, being taken off the field. Actually, he was able to get off on his own power, but he was hobbling. But
he's young, he's strong.
He's a sophomore from Detroit.
And he wants to get back in this game because it's big. It's big. You never know when you'll get back to a game of this nature.
Edwin Dearman, number 73, comes in for him at that right tackle spot. First and 10. Ball's at the 36-yard line. And boy, oh boy, oh boy, where goes Maurice Carr? He got a little rest. He got a little timeout. Big Nate, he had the commercial break. He got his breather. And he's ready to go.
Hey, all you need to do is give a big man a break. Here it is right here, just blowing through the line. Give us a breather, baby. Go to the sideline and get some ice. Quarterback turns, open up. Who did he hand the ball off to? You sure Carr don't have it?
They might have to start double teaming him pretty soon.
So here we go now, second down and 14. Himes. This one is going to be way out of bounds. And boy, I'll tell you what, Brandon Reed, just a sophomore, is hanging all over Scott. I mean, he is all over this guy.
He likes to get physical. You know, one of the knocks on Scotty could be that he only weighs about 170 pounds. Brandon Reed says, well, you know, I can get physical. I can bench press 170 pounds in my sleep, so I'm going to try and do something and get physical and push him out of the sideline. Scotty will make an adjustment. In Scotty's defense, Brandon does have a little help over on the top. So he knows if I make Scotty take an outside release, I've done my job. Just don't let him come inside.
Well, you know, Doug's going to have to make that adjustment because right now the young fella Reed has his intensity up.
So here we go, third down and 14. Himes being flushed out of the pocket. Himes can't get past the defender Fisher, and Fisher does a great job of running him out of bounds. More negative yards for the Tigers.
Great job of them. This was supposed to be a screen pass. You can tell by how he stopped and his delay and his drop back. Randy Himes just trying to make a play there. The screen pass was sniffed out by the Alabama A&M defense. He kind of realized they grabbed hold of my running back there. You see Big Carr knocked the running back off of this track, forcing Himes to take the football and rush to the outside there. A little questionable call there on the sideline, but I think they got away with it. It's a good job of the official letting them play because he clearly had him, but while he was inbounds, just took him out to finish it off.
So they've played 15 minutes of football. And after that 15 minutes, Grambling State has a 7-0 lead. Richmond is your punter, the senior from Lanham, Maryland. In the first meeting, Richmond had to punt the football 10 times. That's what kind of defensive struggle we had, averaging 32 yards per punt. This one is fielded for Alabama A&M by Neil Lindsay. And he has a whole host of Tigers around him as he catches the football, but he's able to hold on to it. That's the most important thing.
Well, definitely, we take a look at their first game they had early in the year. Alabama A&M had five fumbles that game, though.
Our Southwest Airlines first quarter stats, this is. And you can see, we talked about defensive struggle. Grambling, with just two first downs. Alabama A&M has one. Passing yards, 98, but they had the one big play to Scotty Anderson. 3 yards rushing for the Tigers, and we've already told you the Bulldogs will not let you run the football. The Bulldogs going to try to run it themselves this time. And boy, they say Terrence Dukes is the quiet assassin. And the way he came up and put a pop on the quarterback, I now believe them. Taking a look at the rest of the stats, penalty-wise, it's the penalties that the Bulldogs really have suffered with. And some of their drives killed some drives they've had. And possession arrow pointing Alabama A&M's way. And as you take a look again, Grambling State leads this football game thanks to the big play. Scotty Anderson with Brandon Reed all over him makes the catch, takes it inside the 10. And then Ellis Spears very quickly. Touchdown reception, and that's why they lead 7-0. 14:02 left here in the second quarter. And they try to get it to Lindsay. The last time they ran this play, Lindsay picked up 11 yards. This time, he lost some.
Thanks to Robert Taylor. He's over there quick as a cat, man. This guy can play ball. He's a hitter. He's everywhere.
Let's go down to the field and Joe Claire. Joe, what's up, man?
Check this out, y'all. Anything can happen at the SWAC Championship. Now, we understand Grambling is on the field. Alabama A&M is on the field.
You're representing Louisiana, baby. You're going to bring it back home.
But that's not the right shirt, man.
Hey, baby. That's a loser shirt. Well, we beat both of them.
But you not playing today. Hey, look, you going to get beat up in the stands with that shirt on. Hey, man, y'all know how that go.
I was just trying to help you.
Back to y'all up in the booth. I'm trying to protect you.
Yeah, and Joe, you might want to get out of there because, you know.
Yeah, you got on the wrong shirt, too.
I like how Joe's trying to help the guy, putting him on national TV with a Southern shirt at a Grambling game.
Let's take a look at the pressure by the Tigers of Grambling State coming after Robinson.
Robinson on the go. Good thing about this Grambling defense, they're not flashy, they're not pretty, they're just solid.
That
front seven is solid. They got a great DB back there in Spears that enables them to do a lot of things.
Levi Washington trying to get to the outside on the punt return, and once again, good coverage for Alabama A&M, and it's Brian Johnson, who we've already seen make a great tackle earlier in the ball game in a special team situation.
We said that they were solid, too. I mean, the Alabama A&M special teams are rock solid. They try and trick you sometimes, every now and then that shoots them in the foot, but, you know, right now they're winning the battle on special teams as well as field position.
And, you know, I got to tell you, this special team situation is great, Nate, because for Brian Johnson, because this is a guy who lost his position to Reggie Johnson earlier, and when you make those plays special teams-wise, coaches look at you and maybe get you back in.
It's been three tackles, and Brandon Johnson has made three tackles, along with Jamar Ware on one of them. So this guy's not lost heart, not lost face, because he knows you're one play away from being back in there.
Hines over the middle, finds Levi Washington. Washington makes the catch. Talking about great quarterbacks, Jay, you grew up on the West Coast, and I would assume you grew up watching this man right here play for the Rams, the former Grambling State quarterback, James Harris.
All right, that's the man, the myth, the legend. A lot of people don't know. He was one of the true pioneers in terms of black college quarterbacks getting an opportunity to play in the NFL. Played for the Buffalo Bills, went to the Los Angeles Rams. For many years, they didn't think that black college quarterbacks would play in the NFL. He was a pioneer. After him came Joe Gilliam, then came Doug Williams, then came the, you know, today's quarterbacks with the Steve McNairs and all the other QBs out there. And
so then came Jay Walker, 1994 player of the year.
And they're picking on Brandon Reed with Scotty Anderson, but this ball was overthrown.
When you look at a matchup such as this, Jay, and DB is trying to cover with, you know, defending for his life, speak on that. I mean, what do you think about that?
Well, I think one of the things is, you know, Randy's kind of like, hey, you know, you got to win the battle. All I can do is throw the ball throw the football out there. Give me a little bit more separation. This is your game. We're on a deep route like that. You know, a quarterback can only put the ball where it's supposed to be. It's the wide receiver's job to get open, to get a little bit more separation. And I like the fact they're letting them go at it. Brandon Reed's not backing down, and Doug is challenging him as well.
Second down and 10 for Hines. Good pressure by Ware, but he gets away from two defenders. Hines now with a little room out front of him. Gets the first down, finally run out of bounds by Henry Freeman, but not before he picks up about 12 yards on the play.
He's tough. I mean, Randy Hines is tough. He's tough physically as well as mentally. He's gone through a lot this season with the ups and downs, handled the pressure well. And he's, you know, this is athleticism right here at its fullest. He was attacked in the backfield, escaped the pressure, ran, picked up a first down.
Let's go back to the stands. Forget the field, but to the stands with Joe Claire.
Nah, we good, we good.
We'll go back to Joe in a second. Because Joe, you know, he's still trying to work his way maybe out of the stands after he still got my man on TV.
Here they go.
Deep to Anderson. Anderson had gotten past the defender, Brandon Reed, but again, overthrows Scotty. Scotty came into this game second in the conference in receptions with 63. We saw him against Florida A&M make the big play, the 98-yard reception for a touchdown.
I love this here. I mean, this is just throw it and catch it. You know, I throw the ball, you get open and catch it if you can. Brandon's trailing there. Scotty's starting to get a little bit more separation. He's starting to learn how to get more physical with Brandon Reed there. But, I mean, as a football fan, you got to love this. They're out there just throwing and catching it. One-on-one coverage. This is sandlot football right here. Hey, you run down into that tree, cut in, I'll give you the football.
If Brandon Reed will allow it.
And Brandon Reed getting in the way.
Holding penalty was called against Grambling State, moved the football back 10 yards. So now, and I keep seeing first down with the guys with the sticks, so I guess it is first and 20 for the Tigers of Grambling State.
That's what you call first and forever.
First and forever. Hines and a whistle coming as he dropped the football. Good thing that Edwin Dearman, who came in for the injured William Jackson.
One of the things here, he never really got a good grip of the snap, and that pressure was there when he did pick up the football. Duck!
The whole defensive front was this. You know, Maurice Cobb, Robert Matthews, Dante Dawson, who's all SWAC first team. They just, they coming now. Their confidence is up. And, hey, they played all year just to get back here, had a chance to play Grambling in the SWAC Championship.
Because of the miscue, that makes it now second down in four. Four.
Ever.
Second down in never.
Here's Hines looking over the middle. And the ball was too far ahead of his intended receiver, Ellis Spears.
And that's one of the things that Brandy Hines just got to work on a little bit. Receiver Ellis Spears did a good job of getting open there. Hines got a little too juice and missed a throw there where he could have just picked up 10, 12 yards instead of trying to make the perfect pass. Just get a wide receiver a chance to catch the football. He'll get through it. A little jittery right now, and that goes along with the pressure being a quarterback at Grambling.
Let's go on down to the field with Joe Claire. Joe, you with us now?
Hey, check this out. The tensions are high, baby. The tensions, now these students from Alabama A&M are on the Grambling side.
Play over the middle, pass is complete to Levi Washington. What a big play right there. They pick up 31 yards on it, and with that, get the first down.
That's one of the things. That's why it's tough. You know the talent is there. This is a big-time throw and a big-time catch. As a fan and as a coach, you know the talent is there. Randy Hines can do all the physical things you want from a quarterback. It's just getting a little bit more consistency.
And as you see, right, the offensive line finally stopped the rush of the Bama defense and gave him time to do what he needed to do to find his receiver.
So with that play, they get the first down, and what a big first down that was for Grambling State. And came in 33% on the season and converting third down opportunities. First and 10, floater, Brandon Reed, interception by the sophomore. Is he going to try to bring it out?
He brought it out. He did not try. He brought it out. And that is the matchup we're talking about. That is the kid that makes the plays.
See, it's funny because sitting up here in the booth, I see Jay, and Jay talks about the offensive side. You talk about the defensive side. Damn it!
Yeah. And one of the good things you see about it here, this ball has got away. Scotty Anderson's playing nothing but defense during this game here. Brandon Reed, you know, he's back here. He's playing in front of his home folks. It'd be nice to get a 105-yard interception return on national TV, but he's got to learn. Just take a knee there and go down there.
Be a little smarter because I know he's pumped. He's young, and he's playing against Scotty Anderson. He wanted everybody to know that he's got to pick, but I agree with you, Jay. He has to be a little smarter.
So it's first down for Alabama A&M after the interception by Brandon Reed, but he tried to bring it through. Great fake to Parham. Pass up the middle is too high for his intended receiver.
And a lot of times you will see where a big play like that in college football, big turnover by Brandon Reed, and he goes over to the offensive end, and the quarterback just comes out too pumped up, too much adrenaline, and overthrows his receiver.
Neil Lindsay was the intended receiver on that play. So Robinson, who so far is 4 for 9 for 9 yards, not throwing the ball well, and then not getting a whole lot of yards on the ground as they this time keep it down on the ground and give it to their deep back. And the run was made by Parham.
Behind that big left side of the line and Kendrick Rogers and Chance Turner. You know, when you're dealing with a guy like Kendrick Rogers, an all SWAC player, you know, you got to give him his props. You got to give him his touches, as we said, offensive lineman. Let him get a chance to get onto the defensive line.
Parham picked up maybe a yard and a half. That'll make it 3rd down and 9. I formation behind Robinson. His tight end cruises to the right, as he also has 2 receivers to the right. Tried to stick it in the gut of his fullback. And
what a play. What a play by Calvin Spear. What a play by Calvin Spear.
That was
Calvin Spear made a fantastic play. He lined up here on the outside. He had blitz coming there. Oh, you're not going to fool me. He's responsible for outside contain, making sure nothing gets outside of him on the left side. He lined up on the line of scrimmage, started to just chase after Kelvin Robinson full circle, decided, whoa, they tried to trick me here, and just wrestle him down because he's not quite big enough to wrestle down that big running back by himself. He is a DB after all.
So Shug will pump the football. He's in his own end zone, and Washington standing at about the 49. Let's make it midfield. Let this one bounce. Takes a bulldog bounce, and boy, oh boy, that was a dangerous play right there. One of the Grambling State Tigers, Byron Brown, was around the football, and it may have touched him, although it didn't. They're going to say it's down. So Alabama A&M will have it 1st and 10, ball at the 42-yard line. Along with Jay Walker and Big Nate Newton.
Hey.
And we got JC down on the field. I hope JC's okay, because you know he got caught up in that crowd.
Oh.
Started hanging with that Southern fan. Next thing you know.
Yeah.
I don't know. Let's take a look at the pressure, though, by Alabama A&M. Go ahead, Nate. What do you think?
Oh, Jamal Well. Everywhere. We got him on the run. Big Fisher, the linebacker. The kid is taking a beat. Mr. Hines is standing tall in the pocket. A host of Bammers. And we got Brandon Reed. He said 1-1 is 1-1 with Scotty Anderson. It is 1-1.
Meanwhile, you take a look at that big old offensive line right there. I mean, you look at Kendrick Rogers, number 78. But there they are defensively. And they are absolutely outstanding.
Woo!
Scotty Anderson. I want to come back.
Move.
Great move. Getting back down the middle of the field. Getting caught from behind. Good defensive play. And he dropped the football. And they're going to say he's down inside the 10-yard line.
What a play there. You like a little bit of trickery here. What they decided to do, okay, Brandon Reed, you want to get real physical with me down the field. I'll catch the football behind the line of scrimmage here. Great pick there, which is very illegal, by the way. But hey, we'll go ahead. We'll get the ball to you behind the line of scrimmage. Let my best football player create and make some moves for me. And as a quarterback, Randy Himes, you love that one because you're getting all these yards. Just pad your stats, even though Scotty Anderson does all the work there. Let's see if the ground caused the fumble here. And it looks like it's close. But the rule is if both of them have possession of the ball, when you hit the ground, the ball stays with the offense.
Right.
And
I just want to let you know.
And yet, I don't know.
I just want to let you know, he cannot beat Brandon Reed one-on-one, so they did have to resort to an illegal pick.
And our Dante Dawson, number 90, put the boom on Randy Himes on that play, 1st and goal.
Dawson, he's also a first-team all-SWAC selection. So let's don't just get caught up in Anderson and Brandon Reed. There are several players on this field that have been, let's say, gotten honors from the conference for their performance on the season.
There's
number 90, yes, absolutely. But I guess you don't get here to this game unless you've got three or four all-conference performers on your team.
I agree, G Shorty.
Oh, boy. Second down and 12. I got Big Boy working me. I also got Scotty Anderson working it, but I got an interception by Alabama A&M's Henry Freeman. And we've got a flag down at the one-yard line.
I think you're going to see pass interference here on Brandon Reed, I believe.
By the way, Henry Freeman is Brandon Reed's cousin, and they started out the season with a competition as to who would have the most interceptions. Reed with 8, Freeman with 3.
Freeman would need 3 in this game, and we thought it was out of the question coming into the game. But it seems like he tried to get one, but unfortunately, I think his cousin took it from him. Maybe he's trying to win that bet.
His cousin committing the faux pas, huh?
Right here, we got a nice look.
We know that Brandon Reed likes to get physical there. There's only a 5-yard rule where you can keep your hands on that wide receiver there. And it seems like at around the 8 to 10-yard marker, he was still riding Scotty Anderson.
What you think, Nate?
He was riding. And I'd like to say Ron Cooper is doing a good job of covering up for his young guy because Brandon Reed is only a sophomore.
Wow.
And so he's doing a commendable job up to this point.
But they get the first down on the penalty, and the ball is marked now at the 2-yard line. Single setback formation, and here comes Ware. And Hines got rid of the football. I don't know if they're going to say it was incomplete or he was in the grass, but boy, Jamal Ware was in the backfield before that ball got to the hands of
What Hines. Is his name? Jamal Ware. Here, there, and everywhere.
Look at this play.
He was right on the snap there, right up the middle.
It's just a great scheme that Coach Cooper's put together for getting pressure there. Overload the A-gap.
He just confused your right guard there.
And what do you say about a guy that can anticipate the snap the way Jamal Ware does? Do you see that a lot
football,
at the next level?
He's just a football player. That's why
he has a chance to see it, watch him play
the cars fall right to see the next level. Because the guy runs about a 4.4, 4.5, 40. All he does is just make plays. Coach Townsend, the defensive coordinator, loves this guy.
Ball's marked at the 9-yard line. We go to commercial break. 7:13 left here in our first half. Grambling State scored early, but then it's become a defensive struggle. We'll have more here on BET after this.
I'm going to do the same thing with that quarterback.
To our Southwest Airlines SWAC Championship game. Here on BET, Grambling State and Alabama A&M. And the Tigers of Grambling State have a 7-0 lead and the football inside Alabama A&M's own 10-yard line. Knocking on the door, Nate, you talked about the fact that they're making the big plays, but when they got to make those short plays, the Bulldogs stiffen up.
Oh, they get real tough, led by Ware.
And they wanted to try to anticipate the count there and maybe caught offsides. But that's what they like to do here at Alabama A&M. A lot of stunt, a lot of faking the blitz, things of that nature.
And talking to Coach yesterday, Coach Townsend, that is, they said they teaches them to flinch.
Offside on the defense, on the contact, 5-yard penalty, still second down.
They want them to come up. Right here, you see the indecision by the right guard there, not knowing who he's got. What you got to do is come from 0 over the center to 1, 2, 3 and take the inside man out, and you'll always be safe. It'll get a quarterback a chance to see the outside guy.
Who's making those calls, Nate? Who's making those calls?
The center's making those calls.
The center's making the calls as to who has who. Huh?
So if right here, when we see this right here, he should be saying 0, 1, 2, 3, and that's how you block your man from the pad, inside out. Give the quarterback the outside, like he just got hit in the back.
And he got hit in the back. Ball picked up. Bottom middle linebacker. Here comes Fisher at midfield. No one is around him, so he's going to go all the way for a touchdown. Don't see any flags.
That's what Coach Cooper said that he wanted to do. He know that they can't run. Turn into a passing team, make them one dimensional, and win this thing with his defense and his special teams.
That was a big play there. And those Alabama A&M Bulldogs, they're barking over there. You hear the roost way over here.
Uncanny how this team anticipates the snap.
What you got here, right here, this is just a sprint here. running almost 90 yards on the fumble recovery there.
93, actually.
Allowing your offense to stay in the game. Offense not turn over the football, allow this great Alabama A&M defense to win the game. That's just a shot there. The quarterback is defenseless until that guy comes in there untouched with his back turned, and then they miss the PAT. Now they're down by one.
Severn Cannon was the man who forced the fumble. The ball was picked up by Donnell Fisher. Fisher races 93 yards for the touchdown to make it 7-6. But then the point after is
right here,
missed, and that could be a big
see,
one.
Right on the backside, didn't block inside out. Big man comes in, and it bounces off the rear end of the tackle. Fisher takes it all the way. You have to block inside out. Take care of your middle, and it gives your quarterback a chance to get rid of the ball.
So you say, when you say block inside out, is that zone block that? Do you man block
you
that?
You man block it. Or either you step down the zone. Right here, all they got to do is just step down with his left guard should just turned out, because the center should have told him, I got man over. That would have took him to the next man to his left. And all he had to do was turn out and take that guy.
Donnell Fisher came into the ball game with one forced fumble on the season. He now has a fumble recovery and a 93-yard return for a touchdown. We've got a good one here. It's 7-6 Tigers in the lead.
Referees and officials, it's party time now, though, baby. They done score. It's about to be off the hook. Back up to y'all upstairs. It's on the easy, Mokina!
You know what? That is Joe's favorite time when he goes on the sideline, is spending time with the cheerleaders. He does it every ball game.
But Joe, let me ask you this. Now, when Grambling was winning 7-0, Joe was over on the Grambling sideline. He wouldn't leave.
He's not stupid.
Grambling gives up a touchdown. It's a close game. He's at A&M
sideline.
He's not
stupid.
He can't be. He couldn't be one of my fans. He couldn't be a fan.
Joe's not stupid. He knows what to do. So they missed, though, the point after, which could weigh heavily late in this ball game. Because eventually, so that means somebody's going to have to go for two. Unless, of course, Alabama A&M gets themselves a couple of scores under their belt. But one would assume that even if they score again, they're going to go for two just to make sure that they maintain that seven-point margin.
Yeah, and it hurts when you don't have an offense that you don't anticipate scoring a lot of points.
That's right.
If you're going to score three or four touchdowns, okay, you can make it up and just outscore them or kick a field goal. But if you don't anticipate your offense scoring a lot of points, that extra point is very important and crucial to you.
But if Coach Ron Cooper says if he can get up by seven, he'll run the ball in the ground and run the air out of it, and that'll just play right into the hands of his defense.
Meanwhile, the Grambling State Tigers getting return on this football from William Lloyd, and how about the defensive play by Alabama A&M? Brian Houston is the man who came up and made the big stick.
Right here, he's trying to find an open hole, but his ears none. And Houston comes up and delivers.
Those special
all
teams,
the way from the state of Texas. Houston.
Those guys on special teams, they're playing with a half deck of cards. And the guy was already going down. Right. He said, I'm going to give you a little something to make sure you don't get up as fast.
Houston bringing my family along with him from Houston on that one. Had the Lymans and the Jolivets and everybody else behind him on that one.
Yes, sir.
So here we go, first and 10. And the ball is at the 20-yard line for the Tigers with one setback behind Hines. They still have a lead, but it's just 1 point. And Alabama A&M has picked up the defense. Now he's going to throw in a double coverage. And boy, if Anderson had come down with that one, that would have been big time.
That would have been 2-1.
Anderson. Yeah, you know what happened there is Hines is so used to getting one-on-one coverage with Brandon Reed outside. Well, this time Brandon had a little help. He brought one of his partners with him in the form of a free safety to help cover Scotty Anderson on the deep ball.
And the thing you like about this matchup is the more they go deep, they go deep at least twice a quarter. That's going to put a lot of
the penalty decline. Second out.
That's going to put a lot of pressure on the young kid,
too
Reed.
Man,
and he's
going
to play more into the favor of Anderson.
Oh, no, you can't.
And now
no,
you
got to
keep in mind that we know how strong defensively the Bulldogs are. They get a little offense, get a little confidence, and that defense now starts to pick it up. And you could have the Tigers making all kind of mistakes.
No.
They had a penalty on that play, but it was declined. So it's now second down and 10 for Randy Himes. Himes has two backs behind him. In motion, one goes, the fullback, as they give it to the deep back, and that looked like Hill, and we got another flag, and it may be because the back moved too soon. And that's what I'm talking about. That defense now getting a little confidence. you start committing those mistakes.
Well, I'm gonna tell you, play. Boy, those Bulldogs, they fired up. Boy, they just like you got a bone in front of that dog. Anytime you say snap, they're like, I can almost hear them going, you know those real mean dogs down there? You can hear them before they bite you. I don't know if you ever been bit by a dog, but you hear it before you get bit.
5 yard penalty, replay, second down.
Let's go to commercial break. We'll be right back. Half. The Tigers lead by one. The second annual SWAC Championship brought to you by Southwest Airlines here on Black Entertainment Television. Hines looking downfield and almost intercepted and should have been caught by Reggie Johnson, who got burned in the first quarter but had good coverage there.
And one of the things, Reggie Johnson, he's going to go home thinking about this one there. He's running full speed, and I can say this since we're on air. That's why he plays defensive backs.
Oh,
a DB, right, they say, the wide receiver
that
can't
catch.
He's in great position.
He's running that route better than the receiver there. He's making the play on the ball. The receiver becomes a defensive back.
Johnson looking for his first interception of the season and unable to pull this one in.
And one of the things you'll see here while we're showing you this here, even when he's completing the ball, even when he's handing the ball off, Himes is getting hit. A&M has come out here with a clear game plan. Somebody hit Randy Himes every time, even if he's sitting around just watching. Let's put a body on.
So do you think that they got the Louisville tape?
I think so.
There's William Jackson, who we saw walk off the field under his own power, but he was really hobbling, and now his knee is wrapped up. So that means we're going to see a lot more of Edwin Dearman at that right tackle. And we've got a break in the action. And with that having been said, 6:02 left here in the first half. Grambling State up by one. Zone take charge play of the ball game. Severn Cannon coming up with the pow. Up with the gimme that is Darnell Fisher, and he is gone. After a further review on the play, 89-yard return for touchdown. That is our AutoZone Take Charge Play of the Day. Brought to you by AutoZone. The more than 2,800 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. And yeah, they're getting ready.
Getting ready. They're stretching.
Warm up time. They're stretching. It looked like we had a little offsides on that play. Himes is converged on. Young will pick up the loose ball. But again, the Bulldogs coming with the pressure.
Getting a little sensitive up here. Now, that is definitely why they came up with the unabated route to the quarterback there. You got the quarterback Himes here in jeopardy here. Clearly, the math has jumped offside. You got to stop that play there. Then they let it go. You got to blow a whistle here. This guy is unprotected. Oh, those hurt too.
And it...
Replay it down, the third down.
Keep in mind, Robert Mathis, another first-team All-SWAC selection.
He's got a motor on him. He just likes to get physical and go. Him and Ware and Mathis, they're just coming at you from all angles there. He's got a real, real motor that turns being more and more popular, become more popular in the football world, but he just doesn't stop.
Just an all-out player.
Third down and 15. So all of a sudden, the Bulldogs stiffening defensively. Time, back to passing, got good time. Defender slipped down. Scotty Anderson got clear. We got a first down.
Nice throw, nice catch, nice route.
As you can see right there, they're keeping their backs in, and they're letting their backs on this play right here. They're putting their backs in, covering the linebackers in the gap, giving him time so he can read and get out to his receiver, Scott Anderson. That's a great adjustment by Doug and his offensive line coach there.
Donathius Jackson, number 18, was your defender, but he slipped.
Yeah. And I'm going to tell you one thing about that. That's very tough as a quarterback because now you've got two receivers going out against four or five defensive backs. If you're keeping your running backs in, they're not responsible for anything. They can drop into the flat.
But these are not average receivers.
That's true.
Scott Adams and the other kid on that side, Levi Washington.
So here we are, first and 10. Great job getting away from one defender. But Hines is running out of room, and he's still on his feet. Hines, he's got another defender to beat. If he gets a good block, gets it out to the 34-yard line. He may have only picked up 2 yards on that play, but he ran 30 to get it.
It was exciting. He showed his escapability there, but you know what? I think he ran out of air, too, because he was glad to see the sideline. As you can see here, the defensive man is getting upfield there. Good move. He spins. Protect the ball there.
Then Antonio Wallace can't get it.
you could hear me saying get rid of it. That's because I'm not the athlete that Randy Hines was. I would have got rid of it right there and found a place
Pressure's
to throw
on.
It.
I bet right now Ron Cooper is going crazy.
Somebody get him.
He got seven shots at him. He's running. Now he's stretching out. You can see he's looking for the sideline. Thank you.
And with that, he picks up maybe 2 yards on the play. Second down. Again, escapability. Again, escapability. Again, escapability.
Oh, he's on.
The only man that could tackle him.
Frank Livingston.
Was his offensive lineman.
Frank Livingston came out of nowhere and delivered a textbook blow.
I mean, it's tough when you have these defenders coming at you. The Alabama A&M Bulldogs bring it down your neck. But then you make a good cut back to the inside. No! Where'd you come from? Are you my enemy or my foe? That's what they call friendly fire in the military, don't they?
It blew up on him. Antoine.
Look at Mathis. That motor's just going for Mathis. And he's, you know, he can't catch up to Himes. He can move. He can move. He's got a lot of shake with him.
And he's an all-SWAC first team. As you can see, the pocket, the guards are doing a great job. But right now, your tackles are having problems because the pocket is getting closed down. If Himes would have been so jittery that he could have stepped up in the pocket.
This time, his pass is knocked down by Robert Mathis. Gentlemen, Ardante Dawson and Robert Mathis are both first-team all-SWAC selections on the defensive ends for Alabama A&M, and they have been outstanding. You see them right there, number 90 and number 55.
And more so in the fact that A&M is only bringing five people on the rush every now and then, and Grambling's keeping seven people in the block.
But what they were doing earlier was bringing Ware up the middle. They got him backing up now. And now they've shut down the middle. They're bringing him from the outside. But Himes is dropping too far back into the pocket. And that's crushing his protection for him.
Neil Lindsay is back to receive the punt, but Richmond didn't get a whole heck of a lot of that. And the Bulldogs would be well advised to get out of the way as the ball is downed at the 46-yard line, where Alabama A&M will take over, trailing by just one in this football game. Neil, did Melvin tell you to do Airlines and our Southwest Airlines halftime report will include performances from both bands as Alabama A&M. Look at Joe.
It wouldn't be black college football without the battle of the bands at halftime.
And Joe Claire is his court jester.
In motion, Lindsay, Robinson, time. Robinson better get rid of that football. He dropped it. Good pressure by Antoine Lawrence, the sophomore from Brunswick, Georgia. That was
a coverage sack.
Well, that was the potential for some bad problems for A&M.
Because he's making his read right here. But he's just relentless. He's just relentless to keep out.
By Lawrence. Yeah, Lawrence just stayed on him. He missed him the first time, and normally just kind of say, oh.
Yeah.
He continued to pressure and got a sack as well as a fumble anyway.
Almost picked up his third sack of the season. Actually, he did pick up the sack, a loss of one. So now it's second down and 11. And this time they give it inside to the big guy, Travoris Nunn. The sophomore from Mobile, Alabama, picks up about 3 yards on the play. It'll make it third down now.
And Antoine Lawrence is feeling real good right about now. Things are going his way. They seem like they're trying to pick on him, and he's answering the challenge.
Played a pretty good football.
He's feeling even better as they pull him off to the sideline to get a breather. As it now third down, as we now have a timeout on the field, and you see Ron Cooper, and Cooper's got to be happy. He knows that he doesn't have the kind of offense that puts a lot of numbers on the board, but what he does have is a good defense.
He does. And, you know, he also plays.
Try to go in front of the corner.
Let's go down and
listen
to
the coach.
Talking about, he's got a damn problem. Go to the next fucking play. Go to the next play.
Let's go. What you want, coach?
I tell you, things are getting real verbal. I don't want to say verbal abuse, but things are happening real big on the side.
And, you know, important point there is, hey, you made a bad play. Put it behind you. Let's go forward to the next play. We still have plenty of football to play. That last play, you can't go back and change the result. We're just telling the players on the sideline, forget about that play. plays coming forward. This is what we're going to do. This is how we're going to do it. The good thing Coach Cooper's doing with his scheme, not very sophisticated. We're going to run, get you 3 or 4 yards, and then go forward. And on the other side, you know, you'll hear Doug Williams a little bit later on just telling you a completely different approach here.
So here we are, third down situation. Robinson, got a little room up the middle, but he's going to have to get past that defensive lineman. And unable to do so, but we saw a flag come flying in, usually around that area where they call holding. Right, Big Nate?
I don't know about that. I didn't have many in my career. But that can be an issue there.
We talked about Ron Cooper. How about Doug Williams, who respects Ron Cooper? They both have been with their schools 3 years. They came in together.
Drake guys and put the shit in and make it.
You know, down in my mind that Ron Cooper's done a super job at Alabama A&M. Coming in there, we came in the same time, and I think when you look at it from that standpoint, we both is in the same position at the same time. We came here 3 years ago, and we both in the championship game, so I think it's only fitting.
Doug says that with a little swagger in his voice. You can say that about Coach Cooper when you got a 2-1 head-to-head matchup record against him, kind of thinking that your team is the favorite, too, in this ball game here.
Trying to play a little politics. Everybody trying to keep it straight.
Holding penalty charged against Alabama A&M. So now it's third down in for Robinson. Make it even
more
further as Robert Taylor, the middle linebacker, gets free in the backfield and dumps Robinson for yet more minus yards. 15 to be exact.
Right here, you see just great pressure. He's on you. He's an all-SWAC performer. You're not going to get away from him if he's got his eyes on lock and load and sets the tee off on you.
What you find out with most of these young offensive linemen, when you start putting a bunch of guys up on the line, they get confused sometimes. And as when Robert made that play, they had two guys on one and let Robert just run free.
Eighth sack of the season for Taylor, who's second in the conference in that category. Levi Washington back deep. He'll take it. Johnson made the hit. Brian made the initial hit. Slowed up Levi Washington. That's the third special teams play we've seen Brian Johnson get down there and make a hit.
But see, that's, you know, the guy here, man, he refused to give up. He lost his starting job to Reggie Johnson, and he just refused because he knows that, hey, you show the coaches through playing, and, hey, you accept what happened, you're mature enough to play through it and make things happen.
And he got up with a little bit of hobble there. He's got to be careful because he came into this game yesterday in practice.
You're talking about Levi.
Levi Washington came into this game with an ankle that he tweaked sometime last week and actually had an air cast on the ankle yesterday for their practice. I don't know if
I saw the play. It was against Southern. He caught a pass, took it inside the five-yard line. You know they're on that turf down there at the Bayou Classic. So it looked like he twisted it. As he tried to run off the field, he fell. And they had to come pick him up and take him off. You didn't know whether he was going to be able to play, but you got a feeling with a senior, you got to do a lot to be out of this championship game.
Ooh.
The pressure again, and this time it is applied by number 8, Eric Chappelle. So they're getting it from everybody from Alabama A&M. Ware, Brandon Reed, and Chappelle steps it up. We've also seen Dawson and Mathis. Sorry.
Once again, a lot of he beats a receiver. He beats a receiver on a nice arm over move right there, and boom, it's a sack.
This time, Hines tries to take the football up the middle as the clock continues to roll. We are under 1 minute left here in the first half. We're at 52 and counting.
You sure this the Bulldogs and not the Hunters where they're stacking the Grambling State Tigers?
That defense is lock and load, that's for sure.
There's Chappelle, the transfer from Notre Dame.
And he's the guy that said, hey, I put my money on Brandon Reed, and he's even coming up big.
Third down and long. Hines throwing. Scotty open and overthrows him.
Over the history of the game, years and years, there's one person that hasn't missed a tackle and hasn't made it, got an interception scored on it. You know who that is, George?
46.
The sideline. If you're out of bounds, sidelines don't miss tackles. And we saw earlier in the game when Spears made a catch and thought he had a touchdown. He was tackled by the sideline and stepped out of bounds.
So now here we go, 27 seconds left. And they could have maybe tried to take that clock, you know, and just keep the ball on the ground if the Grambling State and maybe run it out. Throwing it in the mission.
Doug is a quarterback, and the mentality of a quarterback is score, score, score. So thinking about others in the football game, like your defense, don't add up sometimes.
So Neil Lindsay will be back to return. Now, see, what they're going to have to do is be prepared for a bad punt, because we had a 30-yard punt the last time that Lawrence kicked the football. And I don't mean to dog him, because he's a homeboy from Maryland. You know what I'm talking about. But, he had a 30-yard punt the last time, and that punt right there looked like it was going 7 yards.
That ball, ball start on the offense, 5-yard penalty.
You better back him up off the chicken, too, boy. He's pretty big to be a punter. Your homeboy is pretty huge to be a punter, boy. I saw him last week against Southern, tried to punted the ball and tried to fake like he was injured after the deal, and it just didn't work.
His longest punt, though, is 60 yards. And one thing about this guy right here, Lawrence Richmond, he's also on the baseball team. So he is an athlete. And this time he gets off a pretty good punt, folks. Lindsay going to take it back at his 22-yard line. Good coverage this time by the Tigers. Back there first with DJ Clay.
And a host of others. Where's Joe Clair?
Joe Clair's in the house.
Where is Joe Clair? We need to talk to the band, see how hyped up the bands are going to be, and where is Joe Clair?
He's with us up here in the booth, folks.
That's what Joe Clair's down for, right? That ODB of the Wu-Tang game.
So with 14 seconds left here, we'll probably end up taking a knee or a running play.
Well, then that's not a Doug run offense, because like Nick said,
Ron Cooper's going to play it smart.
So here we come with 10 seconds and counting. That will be the last play of our first half, and a good one.
Hey, George, where is Joe Clair?
I'm looking for him.
We're putting out an ATB on Joe Clair, y'all. Finally.
Grambling State leading this one by the score of 7-6, but the action doesn't stop there. Our Southwest Airlines halftime report right after this.
Where they will display multi-dimensional motion pack maneuvers to the tunes of 2000.
Birmingham, I hope you're ready to party, because we're gonna put it down with the Cash Money Millionaires, Outkast, Uncle Luke, Trina, Beanie Man, and we're gonna even take you to the movies. Check it out. To all my project chicks, all my hood rat chicks, the ones that don't give a what, just slide with it, just slide with it, get out, now hop it back, and now we're gonna drop these bombs over Baghdad, and we're gonna set it off to my left, to my right, and then back to the middle. Drop it. Pull over that bed too fast. Chick it. Zip Zima, who got the keys in the Beamer? Who am I? Hey, Gremlin, check this out. When you thought we were done, we're gonna lay the smack down like the Rock on your candy band. Set it off. Now drop. Just kick it. Hey, Gremlin, we're going to be like Lawrence Fishburne and Keanu Reeves and get straight Matrix on you. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the AAMU formation for the greatest university on this planet, Alabama A&M University. Bulldogs, let me hear you.
Gentlemen, please give A&M band your enthusiastic applause as they exit with the tune Outstanding by the Gap Band. Located in Huntsville, Alabama, A&M is one of America's outstanding 1890 land-grant institutions where high achievement and excellence is the primary aim. The president is Don Gibson.
Now at the Tiger Marching Band from Grambling State, sit back, relax, and enjoy.
announcer, Christine Turner.
The folks on the Grambling State side with smiles on their faces, and why not? I don't know who young man's going with. I can't tell. Maybe we can check in with him a little later on, see where his face is going. Meanwhile, back on the field, Grambling State gets the football first. And on the kickoff, they take it out past the 30-yard line, where they'll set up first and 10. That return right there for Grambling State by Reginald Prelove. So there's Ron Cooper, the head coach of Alabama A&M, in his third season with this team, and his record is 18-15, but he's been coaching for 8 years. It's 40-18 overall. He coached with the Louisville Cardinals. Before that, was an assistant coach at Notre Dame under Lou Holtz. So he brings a lot of experience to this A&M school, and they've shown it, because in just 3 years, moving from Division II to Division I AA, they are making a statement here in the SWAC by putting themselves in the SWAC championship.
False start, on the offense, 5 yard penalty, still first down.
And this was happening before the end of the first half. It looked like Grambling State was starting to make a few mistakes.
And definitely, this first series here is going to be the most crucial for Grambling. We're going to see if those changes they made at halftime work. That's what they want to find out. They got a lot of pressure. How are they going to combat the pressure what Alabama A&M was putting on them?
The best way to do that thing is just go to the shotgun, or either bring your backs up like you did towards the end of the half, and get them in those gaps, because they don't. Here it comes again. As you can see, the Bulldogs are getting in the gaps again.
The Tigers, seventh in the conference in offense, third defensively. You win with defense. As Michael Young with the carry.
As they all say, offense bring the crowd, defense wins the championship. Yeah, it is. Now, what did you say about special teams? I never really caught that one, Jay.
You know, it's crazy because they don't talk about special teams. Yet when you talk to people, they say, I think it's going to come down to a field goal.
some kicker. Goes,
second down now and 10. Programming, and here comes the pressure again, and this time it's Mathis. Mathis comes into the ball game with 12 sacks, which leads the club. You can add one more to the total after that one.
That was one of his easier ones there. He comes untouched there. They tried, everybody just blocks down. He comes in there untouched. That's almost a give me, but he does a good job of tackling an athletic quarterback, because it's never a give me sack when you have a quarterback that's as good an athlete as Randy Himes is.
Over on that side there, you have Frank Livingston. That's his backside he's got to protect, and Frank's having a hard time with it.
Another loss of 10 yards. That makes it third down and 19 for Himes. Himes in the first half, 8 of 22 for 215 yards. We'll have to throw in this situation. Good blocking this time. He steps up, finds his receiver, who gets away from the initial defender and makes a dive for the first down. Great play right there by Tremont Douglas.
Fantastic play there. Fantastic poise by Himes. He didn't have the pressure that he had there previous in other passes. He does a good job of setting his feet here, dropping back, realizing it's a zone. They're only rushing forward. You got all day. Get outside the pocket a little bit and allow your wide receivers to make plays for you. They miss a tackle, and a great job of tiptoeing the sideline there by Tremont.
And where was where?
He was trying to be on a play, but he flew in there and threw his body instead of wrapping up. Sometimes you have to wrap up. Could have been a great play, but turned out to be a sour play.
So it gives Grambling State a first down. Ball at the 42-yard line. Just underway here in the second half, and boy, Mathis again. Chappelle again. You can throw in Dawson as well.
These coaches are playing chess. Okay, I didn't blitz it last play. You got me. I'm going to bring back that blitz. And they're playing a guessing game of when the blitz is coming, when it's not. And these sacks they're getting, these are just guys that are coming untouched. Untouched blockers.
So that's Chappelle. But at least they're blocking inside out. See right here, they're blocking inside out. Doug has got to devise some way to get a three-step drop and get rid of the ball to try to combat this. Or either go into a max protection and come out of a shotgun.
Doug knew this club could sack you. They came in with 51 sacks as a team, and I said that to you yesterday. Man, you look at this, that was a pro team that
North 51 sacks, I know that's right.
Here we go now. Second down and long, and the pass is incomplete. It was intended for Anderson. This time Ware is in on the play.
Breaking it up. He's a player. He is a player. He's here. He's there. He's everywhere.
Well, let me tell you, For Jamal Ware, he's had at least one sack and one tackle for a loss in his last four games. So you know, every time he comes out to play now, he's going to give you something.
Oh, he's going to give you a lot, man. I mean, his energy, he's not a real talkative player. As you can see, when he's moving around, he's trying to catch his air. He just save all his energy and make plays.
Look at Alabama A&M, 0 for 8 on third down. But here's Grambling State. They are 3 for 8 on a third and 16. Chappelle coming. They dump this one to Michael Young. Young can't get away from Ware. Ware got help from Dawson.
They're playing. They're coming from everywhere. And right now what you've got here is that Alabama A&M defense is just so aggressive. And they're playing great as a unit. And the Grambling defense is doing a good job, too, because they've kept Alabama A&M out of the end zone. What's going to happen here is you're going to need a big play. It's going to be a big play. Like we said before, Heim's stats are going to stay pretty consistent. 8-22, 200-plus yards. He's not going to have a high completion percentage this game, but he can't keep getting hit the way he is.
Lindsey is back standing at his 31-yard line as the clock continues to run. Under 12 minutes now left here in the third quarter. And Richmond with another pretty good punt this time. And Lindsey calls for a fair catch, takes it at the 31-yard line. So that punt right there, good for 37 yards. And now Alabama A&M looking to do something offensively. Championship game here on BET. And we do that for our executive producer, Jackie Coleman.
Jackie who?
No, come on, Jackie Coleman?
Oh, I know
I'm Miss Boss Lady. That's Miss Boss Lady.
That's Boss Lady. She's in the house and she's telling me to go back to work.
Always arguing and nitpicking about something.
She's always on our case. We cannot slack. We cannot slack up. Can't slack up. So first and 10 now for Alabama A&M. Ball at the 32-yard line. Robinson gets out of trouble, has some room, still on his feet, gets a first down. And that's the first time Robinson has been able to shake free of that pocket and pick up some good yards.
But Antoine Lawrence came up the middle. He kept fighting and kind of broke loose and forced him out of there because he had time. But the Grambling's defense, the secondary, had a nice play there. See, he has time. But Antoine Lawrence will keep working and keeps working and shakes him out of there. That's great coverage by the secondary of Grambling. Because that was a coverage. That could have been a coverage sack.
This time, the Bulldogs give it inside. Or actually, that was Robinson. And he may have picked up a yard on that play, making it second down.
You know, these two defenses, they bend a little bit, and then but they just clamp down like a pair of grip pliers. They just clamp down and shut each other down, man. And it's just tough sled for both coaches to figure out what can he do on offense to make plays.
Kind of interesting to see that Alabama A&M not getting it done on the ground, but we know that the Tigers, second in the conference in terms of rushing defense. I mean, while Alabama A&M is great at that, so is Grambling State, allowing coming into the ball game just 87 yards per game to their opponents on the ground. And one of the four teams that they would hold under 100 yards rushing is Alabama A&M, who had just 62 yards in their first meeting.
But since then, Alabama has picked up the game, running behind that left side of the line and making things happen. But today, you know, you got one and two defenses playing against each other, so you expect this type of game to be played.
And A&M was held under 100 yards rushing just four times this year, Grambling State being one of those teams. Here's Donnell with the carry. He's going to be close to another first down. I mean, if they mark him inside the 45, he does have a first down. And that's what they'll do. They'll move the chains as you get a good look at Curtis Donnell, who we saw win the Magic City Classic MVP.
Right here, Kevin Roberts tosses out. Curtis Donnell, he wants to cut up, but he sees a step and slides out. Fights for the extra yard. It's just a simple toss play, getting outside, trying to let him run and show his talents.
Donnell is the second leading scorer in the SWAC this year. He had 15 touchdowns, four on the ground, one courtesy of the air.
With that triple out they running?
This time they give it inside to Marvin Strong.
But you know what? That's an interesting thing because they talk a lot, at least from the Alabama A&M side, that every week they've done something new,
right.
Something you haven't seen before. And maybe that triple I you're talking about is something they threw in new for this football game.
You know, but it didn't work because they gave it to the fullback instead of letting that guy that was in the back do some pain. So you lost two players on that play.
Well, here they go with that same formation.
Triple I.
This time, Robinson gives it to who? He said Nate. That's Donnell, who makes a cut. Turns it upfield on second down and 10. Looks like he picked up close to 6-7 yards.
It's good to see them starting to get Curtis Donnell involved in the football game. I mean, we didn't call his name a whole lot early on. Veer option. Their quarterback does a good job of freezing the defender, and Donnell just makes this move on himself, makes two guys commit to going outside, cut back inside. We also mentioned he likes playing in Birmingham.
And so Coach Cooper is trying to say, hey, I'm going to try to take Taylor and the other two linebackers out of the mix by trying to get outside and just let these guys use the open field talent.
Third down now, that triple I. This time, they give it to the scat back. He takes it in for a first down. That's Melvin Gideon on the carry.
He was a little giddy up then to make things happen. So Melvin Gideon did a great job there, getting outside and making a guy miss.
So Gideon with his carry takes it inside the 35 for a first.
As you can see right here, they run the fullback in there to make him suck in on that, and then he gets outside with Gideon. What he's trying to do here is give his quarterback more than one option. What it is really all option is just a backfield pass, just reading off different options, run the fullback in there, pull the ball out, then toss it out or even keep it itself. So it's making Grambling adjust to a new look there.
This time they give it to the deep back, and that's Corey Parham. That sophomore takes it.
I talked to the offensive coordinator, and he said we should be seeing a lot of Corey Parham, especially in the second half if they're close and have any type lead in this game.
Well, I talked to that same coordinator, and he told me we love to run the football. We love this offensive line, and they love the run block. Isn't better to run block than that pass block in Nate and Nate? Is it easier to run block?
For our offensive line, this because you get a chance to get out to people, lean on people, make things up. I know Jay doesn't agree with that, but it's because it makes for a boring game. But if you have a better chance of staying in the game and winning when you're playing an explosive team such as Grambling, do you agree, Jay Walker?
I think so, and I think in this case, they're just getting back to their roots. I mean, you got to understand that Alabama A&M started off as a pure Veer team.
Right.
And they were used to running the Veer for many, many years. And what they're doing is giving the quarterback a triple option here. He can decide to give it to that first guy, keep it himself, or pitch it. So they are giving him three options with that triple I that they kind of patented. So in this case, to give you a long answer, yes, I agree with it, because you're going back to what your kids feel more comfortable with, which is running the football.
Well, they came in averaging 154 yards as a team on the ground. That's third best in the SWAC. And it's third down now, but you got the feeling running it isn't going to get them the first down. So Robinson, good protection, swings it out. Barham is upended by Calvin Spears. He'll be short of a first down.
But they need some points of some kind here, because Grambling is always a threat to score. So in some way, somehow, they may be in four down territory, so they might have to get a score. So by field goal, by running, by passes, it have to happen.
Just take care. You just got your basic drop back pass. You have plenty of time here. Commits to the swing route a little bit earlier than you like. You like to let the defense get a chance to move back a little bit further so they can pick up the first down.
And another flag. And that's the second time that penalty's been called, breaking the huddle with 12 men on the field. And that guy that they're calling was on his way off the field at the time. Let's go to commercial. We'll talk about that when we get back. George Johnson, along with Nate Newton and Jay Walker, Joe Claire, also on the sideline.
Where's Joe Claire?
We just saw that penalty, that 12-man penalty.
And that is a coach's problem, too, because the coaches are sending the players in and out, so they got to know the packages and the sets that they're trying to get. So that's a coaching problem, too.
Shug with a punt, trying to get it inside the 10, maybe even the 5, but it rolls out of bounds at the 11, a 19-yard punt. Travis Shug.
That's Shug's. Is it Travis Shug's?
There's no S on the end of that. Well, you working this today, aren't you?
We knew that this would become a defensive struggle. We've got the pictures to prove it.
Here we got pressure by them.
We'll look at it in a second. On first and 10 for Grambling State, and Young is taken down. But here you go, Nate. Let's talk about that pressure.
Pressure of the Bulldogs is tremendous. As we have right here, we have Matthews coming from the outside. We got Chappelle coming from the outside. And definitely, you know where it's everywhere. This is a top-ranked defense, the Bulldogs.
Young lost a couple of yards, four to be exact, on that last play. So Mike's loss makes it a second down and 14 as Tigers are deep in their own territory.
And losing momentum.
Here's Hines, Scotty Anderson, great catch. As good Reed throw. Let him get behind him.
Good throw, good catch. That's that matchup we talked about a little bit earlier between Anderson and Reed, and they're playing pretty close like a standstill. Good throw here. The quarterback sets his feet, quick drop, throws it on the money. The talent is definitely there. It's just a matter of getting the consistent execution.
And the mistake that he made is he went for the double move, and most young guys will, and Scott Anderson schooled him there.
That was
on a nice double move.
That was a nice route.
Nice route.
And then they're mixing it up a little bit.
Yeah, right now it is 5-2-2 in Scotty Anderson's favor.
Again, we have the big matchup between Scotty Anderson, number one, and Brandon Reed, number 29, both all SWAC selections, first teamers. As Himes goes back in the air, and this time, the eighth leading receiver in the conference, Levi Washington, makes the catch.
Yeah, he's getting up hobbling, but he's a real tough guy. Doug was not worried. I say Doug Williams was not worried about Levi Washington playing in this game. Air cast and all. He said he's a little tough guy, and you know, quiet as kept, he's been almost like an MVP for this team here. So much pressure going to Scotty. He's carried us through a couple of games.
Right, I noticed you said, Doug, what y'all on the first name basis?
17-yard pickup for Levi. First and 10, now at the 41. You guys talked about how momentum was leaving, but it looks like the Tigers now are finding some room, although that pass was out of the reach of the intended receiver, Chris Hyshaw.
As you can see there, you know, you make a big play on the Bulldogs defense, then you come back and it seems like you just stall and you just peter down to nothing. And like I say, they will bend, but they won't break. And as you get closer to their end zone, their red zone, with their backs to the wall, they tighten up and they get mean.
So
there's Doug right there saying, oh, if I could play. Only if I was the quarterback. I knew we would win this game.
Certain teams you want to play against, certain game teams you don't want to. I don't know who wants to be a quarterback in this game.
They're looking like they're getting ready to bring pressure again from the outside. He gets it off.
Yes, he does. Pass is caught by Hyshaw, who was his intended receiver that last play. Hyshaw picks up about 4 yards, but we've got another flag on the field over at the 45-yard line.
What we got?
What they're doing here is just getting a quick throw. They realize they have a couple people that they can't account for in their blocking scheme. So they're telling the quarterback, just get rid of the ball quickly. We're shortening up the routes that the receivers are running, taking the quick pass, and then setting up the deep pass later.
Down the field on the offense, 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay second down.
But with penalties like that, it goes all for naught.
Right. As we talked about earlier, it seemed like you'll make a big play on this Bulldog defense, and then they just come right back at you with some type of play.
Here is the way it looked the last time these two teams played. Alabama A&M had a 14-3 lead, and then Robert Taylor had 63-yard interception return for Grambling State that made it 14-10, and then Scotty Anderson caught a 20-yard pass from Himes to give them the victory over Alabama A&M. That time it's Hyshaw. Now they're going to start going to Hyshaw. That's the third straight time they've thrown to the young man from Monroe, Louisiana.
That was a big time throw by Randy Himes. He's throwing the ball to the furthest side of the field on a slant route. That's pure arm strength going from one half on the far right back across the field to the far left. And Hyshaw does a good job of getting big again. He's a tall kid and catching the ball first because he had a little drop earlier.
I agree with you there.
He's 6'4", so yes, he does have some size, 180 pounds. Now with two receptions, came in averaging 11 yards per catch. Here's Himes, and this time, and once again, he was looking for Chris Hyshaw.
You know, where it was up in the line then, he was right on the snap count. We can see that again. Whoa. That would be tremendous. Huh? I mean, that, and I promise you, the quarterback saw that. He glimpsed that and said, oh, cool, here they come. And he had to get rid of that. I'm telling you.
Yeah. No replay. Thank you, sir.
Again, we talked about how they anticipate the snap count. And while we were away in our break, we talked about how many guys for Alabama A&M's defense step it up. Ware, Dawson, Fisher.
Matthews.
Chappelle, who's coming in.
High Chaparral.
You know? And even Brandon Reed
is holding down his own against a veteran Scotty Anderson.
Doing the best against one of the best. So Lawrence will kick the football off, and Lindsey will take it at the 17, 18 yard line. He's going nowhere. 2:52 left here on the third down. Legion Field is the site for the second annual SWAC Championship game. Alabama A&M trailing Grambling State 7-6, but the Bulldogs of A&M with the football, and that was the quarterback, Calvin Robinson, with a carry for about 4 yards.
And it's amazing how we talk to these coaches during the walkthrough the day before the game, and you watch them, each one of them trying to, play it real cool and say the right things. But I got a feeling that Doug said, hey, I wanted to see these guys a second time so he can make some things happen, you know.
So here they go again, second down. This time they give it to Darnell. Darnell works his way close to yet another first down. Looks like he's going to be a yard shy. I'm George Johnson. This is Jay Walker and Nate Newton up here in the booth with us, bringing the play-by-play of this SWAC championship game.
George, where are you at? Oh, there
George.
He is. Not about his
George. I can't see his
George.
Hey, there you go.
I'm glad they have something to laugh about.
George is better known as Shorty G.
So here we are, third down situation for the Bulldogs, and they give it to Darnell. Darnell picks up the first down. I got to tell you, Curtis Darnell has been on a roll, folks. 3 weeks ago, he ran for 133 yards against Alabama State. Then he ran for 135 yards against Jackson State and 93 against Arkansas Pine Bluff. So he's given them some big games lately, number 34 for Alabama A&M. And he's the top rusher today with 20 yards.
Behind Kendrick Rogers and Chance Turner, a veteran left side up the offensive line, doing a great job blowing open holes. Now they're trying to get outside, which is going to be pretty hard because them three linebackers that Grambling has can flat out run.
And that was George Guidry, the senior from Lake Charles, Louisiana, number 47, the second leading tackler on this team, and a transfer from the University of Nebraska who came up and made the play.
Yeah. He's a good football player, too.
Very good football player.
Take a look at what Coach Cooper decided to do. It's Kelvin Robinson's last game. He's a senior, giving him a chance to go out there and show what he can do in this final game by not passing the football, not too much, but by giving him those options with the beer offense that he's used to running, that he ran when he first got there, and keeping the ball in his hands, and he's making a decision when to pitch and when to keep it.
So here he is now. They're going to try the reverse, but Grambling did a good job, at least you thought they did. A nice move by Lindsey to elude Willie Gray, number 74, but he couldn't get past Calvin Spears.
But see, when you're a big guy like that, and you get penetration, you've done your job. He done his job by making that guy hesitate.
Right.
And with the great speed of a Robert Taylor and a Gentry, they can recover real fast.
What you're not going to do is you're really not going to beat a sound defense like Grambling with some type of trickery. I mean, Grambling's done a good job of staying at home. They're very disciplined, very, very disciplined, and all their players are where they're supposed to be. So they're playing in some type of harmony. Same with Alabama A&M defense as well. They play fantastic.
That young lady very disciplined there.
I don't know if you wanted to be very disciplined.
So we got the elbows up. She's doing it right.
We've come to the end of the third quarter. We've played three quarters of football.
I'm telling you, it was on 28-29.
After three quarters, Grambling State leads 7-6. This portion of today's game is brought to you by 1-800-COLLECT. And this is our collect connection play of the game, and that's Scotty Anderson. And it may not look like a great play, but the key was he got behind a very good cornerback and Brandon Reed. Himes delivered the pass and he made the catch. This portion of today's game brought to you by 1-800-COLLECT, the easy way to save.
What's wrong with this picture? The fact that you're still sitting in front of it. Do something more interesting.
Yeah.
You will sell your corporate clothes. You will wear shorts to work. Your favorite colors will be red and gold.
Most people smile about 50 times a day. Laugh at a joke maybe 15 times a day. With exposure like this, shouldn't your teeth be whiter? Introducing Colgate Sparkling White Toothpaste with special micro-cleaning crystals for an advanced clean to make you shine. So laugh, smile, scream as much as you want. Live life. Make sparks. New Colgate Sparkling White.
This portion of today's game is brought to you by 1-800-COLLECT, the easy way to save. I sure love it when they start dropping that music.
Yes. Makes it
easier to do what
B-E-T
you got to do.
B-E-T only.
That's what I'm talking about. Third down now for Alabama A&M, and they have some yardage to gain, and they're not going to gain it because the quiet assassin, Terrence Dukes, is there to make the play. And let's go down to Joe, who's leaving the broadcasting field and becoming a delivery man.
You found Joe Claire.
As y'all can see down here, I have to do everything. I got to get the piece, deliver the piece. I got to do everything down here on the thing. Now, the Grambling players are hungry, so I'm going to go over, give them a slice of pizza or whatever, whatever, see what that happens. You know, that might help them or whatever. But they said they wanted some pizza, so I went and got some. I'll holler at y'all later. Who got enough pepperoni? Large?
I noticed we ain't going to get none of that pizza. Oh, no. DJ Clay is the man deep. But look at this punt right here. Shug punted the football 71 yards.
Wow. That was a nice punt.
Good leg.
Travis, who's longest prior to that one, was 63 yards.
Yes. So I guess there's no point in me telling you that he can kick. He can kick.
He's a junior from Chandler, Arizona. You've asked that question many times. How do some of these kids from Arizona and California find their way on the East Coast to play with these teams?
And there's one answer and one answer only. The better football is played on the East Coast and down south in the dirty south. Thank you.
Okay.
Whoa. What we want to get exposure to. Get to the next level, you come with the best play. Right, Jay Walker?
First and 10 on the 20-yard line.
This is our Southwest Airlines SWAC Championship game, so we have the two best teams in the conference going at it. And on first and 10, pass was intended for Highshaw. Highshaw all of a sudden becoming a fixture in his offense. We didn't see him once in the first half.
When you got a guy like Scottie Anderson playing, and doing what he's doing, your second and third receivers should come up big. Because believe me, even though Brandon Reed is doing a decent job on this guy, they're bracketing, they're getting a safety over the top, or either outside linebacker coming underneath to help this guy. So the second and third receivers should make plays.
Second down situation for Himes. Himes over the middle. Scottie Anderson, as you said, stepping up large. Tackled by Henry Freeman, but not before he picked up close to 15 yards on that play.
I think Chappelle was trying to go with him, but he's limping off the field here, cramping up, trying to run behind him.
Good pocket here. What Grambling decided to do is spread him out. Yeah, you see Chappelle there, pull up there on that one there. That's what happens when you're chasing those jackrabbits around. Scottie does a good job of getting lost in the zone, coming across there, gearing down, getting the ball, then making a move, not moving backwards, always trying to go forward.
Anderson with 5 receptions for 144 yards. Highshaw makes the play.
I'm pretty sure Highshaw, we're seeing a lot of Highshaw. I'm pretty sure Levi's Washington ankle started to mess with him a little bit.
Yes.
A player of that caliber, you want him on the field. They're using 5 wide receivers and not using him, so he must be limping a little bit.
See right here, quick snap, which is shotgun. He gets back, get his feet set, look, goes back the other way, gets rid of the ball quick because he knows pressure's coming.
Jermaine Mobley is the man who came up and made the tackle for the Bulldogs, but not before a pickup of 7 yards, second down and 3. And Himes goes back into the shotgun. Anderson's your slot receiver. This time they tried to hand it off inside to Michael Young, and Again, how many times do we have to say it? You're not going to run on this team. Maurice Carr is the man who made the tackle there, number 95, the senior from Nashville.
They got him 6'1", 290. Bro, I'm saying about maybe 5'11", 3-plus bills. And I'm not one to go after another big man because I'm huge myself. But Maurice Carr is making a dent in this offensive line.
Yes, he is.
A dent.
Yes, he is. I mean, Larry McTeva need to pick it up. Come on, big fella.
It's fun. It's interesting about Carr. This team has a lot of sacks, but he had just one of them coming in. But a great run stopper and what Mr. Carr.
And what he does for the guys that he does is that he provides that pressure in the middle. He just keeps pressure in the middle. And that shortens the clock.
As you can see on the side, warming up. And this is the young freshman quarterback, Chris Gunn. And Gunn has completed 52% of his passes playing in his first year here. And is, in fact, ranked among the top 10 in the SWAC in passing.
Not Gunn.
Yes, Gunn.
That'd be a nice name for a quarterback.
Oh, huh? Man, if he come up and be what he needs to be, if he comes and reaches his potential, boy, that'll be a nice name for the future.
Lindsay is back again to receive this punt. And it takes a great rambling roll as it is going to be downed at the 21-yard line, a 38-yard punt. Just 12 minutes left in this football game to determine the champion in the Southwestern Athletic Conference. And immediately they go to the air, and this one is complete to Kenyon Hambrick. Hambrick's first reception of the ball game. Hambrick came in with 59 on the season, third most in the SWAC.
Very good quarterback on the throw here. Very good job by the quarterback. Get out the pocket a little bit, throw it to your playmaker. Open up the offense a little bit. We've been trying to fool each other and run for the past three quarters. Fourth quarter, let's let it all hang on the line. We got to throw the win, let's throw the football. Hambrick does a great job of catching and bringing it in.
15-yard pickup. Sorry about that, Nate. 15-yard pickup. Here's Lindsay. On that wide receiver screen, picks up 11 yards on that play. So that play has worked two of the three times that they've run it.
Yeah, and it's made by Kenyon Hambrick out there on the outside. He did a great job of blocking or preventing Spears from getting into the backfield to tackle Lindsay there. They've been trying to do it. They scouted that. That's one of those things you get from watching so much film, one of the weaknesses out there.
Our Dante Dawson urging on his team offensively. He trailed by one. As we approach 11 minutes left in the game, Robinson. And is it another catch?
Well, he caught it. Great catch.
You could see that he was trying to convince the officials that I made this catch. That's Robert Wimberly with the catch.
Right here, he drops back, sets quick, throws a nice strong ball. Catch. Well, I don't know if he caught it. What do you think there?
Always a catch, Nate. Always a catch.
I'm
just going to jail. I'm just saying, you know.
Don't question the player of the year in 1994.
Yes, sir.
Wimberly with a 13-yard gain on that play, and all of a sudden, here come the Bulldogs.
He's got some room.
He has room on the quarterback stand. He's got room. Still on his feet. Spears can't bring it down. But we have a flag that is now on the field at the 36-yard line, and you can see that one of the offensive linemen is upset. There's going to be holding called against the Bulldogs.
Did Kendrick Rodgers?
I didn't do it.
Premature celebration there. Great run by the quarterback. Unfortunately, that little yellow marker there makes it bring it back. One of the things here that you hate to see is a great run like this negated by a penalty there. You know, did he hold in order to help him get free? I don't know. Let's see.
Holding, only offense, only running play. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Still first down.
Nate. Yeah, why do you hold on running plays?
It was, I don't know. As you see right there, yeah, he holds him straight up. Taylor shoots the gap. Big Kendrick holds him to try to keep him from making a play on the quarterback, but it's too late. I hate to see that for a big offensive line, but he did hold on that play right there.
For shoulder pad.
And Rodgers, first team All-SWAC selection, considered one of the best in this conference.
But he's started
34 straight games for the Bulldogs.
But it took an All-SWAC player and Robert Taylor to make him make that mistake. And that quarterback got on them big old quarterback shoulder pads.
Let's go to commercial break. 10:37 left here in our football game. Welcome back to the SWAC Championship game. Holcomb for Alabama A&M gets to know Marlon Williams awful well.
Nice open field tackle. Came up and made a great play.
Today's 1-800 collect. This portion of the game is brought to you by 1-800-COLLECT, the easy way to save. Alabama A&M, 5-3, the champions of the Eastern Division, and it looks like they want to just throw a little option pass. Robinson, oh! Stolen by Spears! Spears is going to go the other way, and that is going to turn things around. Kelvin Spears, three-time All-SWAC performer, with his sixth interception of the season.
They kept trying to trick this sound, fundamental football team. All game long, Spears has not been fooled for the deception. He stayed at home when he needed to, and that time they paid off for him in a big way.
And the nice thing about it, he went up and got the ball at his highest point and stole it away from him.
Alabama A&M been setting up the double pass all day. The quarterback throws a lateral and was going to get the ball back on a screen to the other side. Athlete like Calvin Spears, did you see the elevation he got off the ground? He's got a great vertical leap, catches the ball there with nothing but daylight.
Big players make big plays in big games.
And this is a huge game there, and that's why he's been an all-SWAC performer every year he's been a Grambling.
45-yard return for Calvin Spears, the junior from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. The kick is up, the kick is good, and Grambling State takes an 8-point lead, 14-6.
Look at these hops.
It's brought to you by 1-800-COLLECT, the easy way to save. And Calvin Spears saving his crew. But the interception return for 45 yards. Alabama A&M tried some trickery. They threw the lateral to Lindsey, and he was looking to go back to his quarterback, but Calvin Spears, the veteran, was there to make the interception and take it back. And I'll tell you, Grambling State has a lot of players whose fathers played in the game, Levi Washington. Spears is another one. His father, Calvin Nicholas, played for Grambling State and then went on to play for the 49ers. Good lineage here. Here's Lindsey on the kick return to the outside. Lindsey taken out at the 43, and the auto throw penalty as he got taken down 5 yards after he got out of bounds.
Your wish is their command, because you did get the flag.
When you talk about that last play, as you guys said, he made a mistake, but it was the pressure that caused him to do this.
It was. He would have liked to hold the football a little bit longer so he could throw a pass that didn't float in the air as long. But when you got a defender wrapped around your ankles, it makes it kind of tough to get any type of velocity on the football.
First and 10 for Alabama A&M. Believe me, folks, this thing is far from over. If they get 8 points here, they can tie it up. But you would expect a guy like this, Kenyon Hambrick, to make the catch in that instance. Because like big guys have to come up with the big plays.
Right. A guy like Kenyon Hambrick, you have to keep him in the game. I mean, he's not been in the game. He's caught one pass. They haven't thrown his way maybe but twice. So he's getting a little cold. And receivers, they're finicky guys. You know, they're kind of like a cat. Sometimes they eat the food when you give it to them, and sometimes they don't.
More importantly, Alabama A&M's opening it up. They realize it's a sense of urgency. They're coming out passing formations. They're trying to score quickly. They don't know how many more touches they're going to get.
Second down. Clock still rolling. 9.5. This time, dumped off. And again, Hampert can't make the catch.
Says a lot for you when, you know, one of your best players on offense and definitely your go-to guy in terms of wide receiver is not making those catches for you. You kind of need those. As you see, Guidry coming there with the pressure staying on and letting them know. Robinson does a great job of getting rid of the ball. Ron Johnson's all over him. He does a great job of getting rid of the ball. And he's trying to make a play. That's how a senior's playing. Kelvin Robinson really wants this game. He just needs a little bit more help from a supporting cast.
Johnson with four sacks, had two sacks in the first meeting, number 55 for Grambling State. Third down situation, Robinson. Robinson was forced to cut back inside because big Robert Taylor had his eyes on him and sort of scouting him out, making sure he didn't go anywhere.
Pin him down. Grambling started to feel it. The guys are dancing around to the music. Here it is. He moves around. Good coverage. He just breaks up the middle. Boy, they had a bead on him. He did a good job of getting out of the way.
So here's the situation. We've got 8:49 and counting here in our fourth quarter, and Alabama A&M is down by 8 points, and obviously they consider this to be an important situation because they're calling a timeout right now. What are you guys thinking? Are you going for this fourth down? Would it be fourth down and six, or are you trying to punt it, keep them deep in their territory and rely on your defense?
Well, me being the smart coach, I figure my defense would get the ball back for me, so I would just punt it away.
So we'll see what Ron Cooper decides to do when we get back from this commercial break. For Grambling State, Alabama A&M with a fourth down situation, and they're going to go for it. Fourth and six, Robinson going deep to a big-time receiver and almost intercepted by Spears. Would have been his second. They were looking for Torrey Day, the junior from Birmingham, and Spears was all over
it. I figure right there, Coach Cooper thought he didn't have anything to lose by throwing it deep, such as a punt right here. Receiver takes off deep. It's just like a long punt. If no interception, even with an interception, they bring it out to the 20. So, but I would have took a chance with the punt and got them deeper back into their territory.
So 8:38 left, and the pressure now falls on the shoulders of the Bulldogs. And once again, the pageantry.
Play be like this.
Why are you looking at me when you say pageantry, George?
He don't want his wife to get on when he get home.
14-6, 8:38 left.
Buck, go. We got it. It's a sack, right?
In the shotgun. Hines drops it off to Anderson. Looking to get to the outside. And Reed says, nothing doing. And make sure he doesn't throw him to the ground and pick up a 15-yard penalty.
Smart
in the process.
Player. Smart player. Grambling really does need to pick up a couple first downs here because the way they Alabama A&M defense has been putting that pressure on their quarterback and making them take three plays and out, the A&M's going to get the football a couple more times.
My question is, are we playing intramural football or are we playing football? Because the clock's still rolling, and if I'm not mistaken, wasn't he out of bounds?
Hey, swag official.
The clock continues to roll at 8:03.
Get a little cold. Maybe they're ready to go.
They're ready to go. I thought he was out of bounds. If I'm Alabama A&M, I'm looking for my time back. They've got to, you know, try to save some as Grambling State goes out to the receiver, Spears, who makes the catch, and Ellis picks up about 7 yards on the play. But again, now the clock's rolling, and it can roll at 7:40 and counting. But that play prior to that, the guy was out of bounds.
Yes,
and the clock never stopped.
One thing you can't really complain about, I mean, you are playing in Alabama. If that happens when you're on somebody's home field
right
at Grambling, so then you kind of complain a little bit. But we are in Alabama.
Are you bringing up your days in Tallahassee or anything like that? Oh, we got the big boy down.
Yeah, leave Nate alone, man. Nate swears that clock works. It does work.
Third down. Great pressure by the Bulldogs, forcing Hines to throw it out of bounds. Now, that should stop the clock, and it did.
And Chappelle all over him. They've been there, Chappelle and Mathis. Those guys have just been all over the quarterback's face all day. Did a great job there. They got your offense the ball back after only giving up three plays. They're going to punt it. Now the offense needs to step up and do something.
7:12 left. Sorry.
They're there to punt it into the end zone. They've been on the 20, and now we've had they would have made up 20 yards just on the punt.
It would have been a shorter field.
Right.
So Lawrence will punt. Deep to receive is Lindsey. Lindsey is at his 23-yard line, and again, I mean, you take your chances on Lawrence Richmond when it comes to punting the football, and every now and then he's going to hook you up. We'll let you know after this 10-yard punt. Def Jam of the South.
Yeah, we had an off-the-field injury over at the far cone over there.
So here we go now on a first down for Alabama A&M, and the pass thrown deep is intercepted by Grambling State's Marlon Williams. Calvin Robinson looking for the big play and looking for Dondra Holcomb. Overthrowing, and Marlon Williams comes up with the interception, his second of the season.
They're getting a little antsy. He just wants to try and make a play. They're trying to get to the end zone any way they can. He's getting knocked upside his head as he throws the football. But you know what happens here? He just kind of throws it up for grab, overthrows a wide receiver, and a good defense is going to make you pay for little mistakes like that.
They truly paid right there. I'm surprised that Coach Cooper would just go for it all right there.
And Holcomb was wide open. I mean, he looked like he was open on that flag pattern, but they just delivered the ball too late. We have some movement on the offensive line on this first down situation as they give it to the deep back, Michael Young. Young looks like he's going to lose a yard on the play, but we'll have to wait and see if they throw a flag. They didn't. So the clock continues to run.
So you just getting weary. You just getting leery of those flags yourself, huh, Joe?
Flag shot. 6.5 minutes left.
Right here, you know, Coach Cooper is relying a lot on his Bulldog defense to stop Grambling, but Grambling can open it up. So look for something down at the bottom with Scotty and Brandon Reed to happen real soon.
High formation. Hines going to throw. This time he's going to hold on to the football. Make a nice move and get the first down. Great play by Randy Hines on the quarterback draw. Picked up 12 yards.
He's tough. And he's very tough, and that's the word they use over and over to describe. He's a tough kid, and he makes plays when he has to. You know, just had the one niche this year. He had one bad game, but he made a key play there because they really need to get a first down to slow down the momentum that Alabama A&M defense is getting.
Himes has thrown for 300 yards in this football game, 17-37, one touchdown to Ellis Spears. He's been intercepted twice, but he picked up a big first down there.
Very quiet.
It hasn't been a pretty 300, but it's 300 is 300, no matter how you get it, whether you're loud, whether you're quiet with it.
Go back home and look at that box score, and you start looking at your boys going, that's a 300.
Let's steal first down.
So now the clock's going to start working against Alabama A&M. But again, they are not out of this thing. They only trailed by 8. That's a touchdown and a 2-point conversion. But defensively, they've got to make a stop on Grambling State.
Here and now. So where is Jamal Ware?
Been kind of quiet past couple of series, huh?
Yeah, they're keeping an eye on it.
First down, penalty charge against Grambling. They're going to run that quarterback draw again. Himes falls down before Chappelle and Ware get a hold of him. As we get to 5 minutes left here in our football game.
It's been real tough on the Grambling front five offensive line today. Frank Livingston, Terry Riley, Larry McTeva, Kevin Thomas. And I think Big William Jackson is out, so they put another guy in for him. But it's been real rough on them today with Big William Jackson out of there.
You saw that sat with Hines rushing the ball 15 times for minus 13 yards. Those haven't all been designed runs. A lot of those have been sacks.
And those sacks count to your rushing totals in college football. Hines passing complete, intended for Ellis Spears at his feet.
Hines knew right there. He released that in a funny way because, you know, he didn't say anything to the receiver. He just bent over like, whoa, I blew that one.
Like, whoa,
I blew that.
4:28 left. There's Doug Williams in his third year with Grambling State. Team got off to a 9-1 start. They were number one in black college football. Last week, they got beat at the Bayou Classic by Southern, and you wondered how they would rebound. Were they looking past Southern towards this championship game?
I don't think so.
Here's Hines. Not a big rival like that, right?
Yeah, they have a big rival. They ran into a bus all of a sudden. And for the record, Southern is probably playing the best football of all the black colleges at the end of the year. I mean, Southern got hot. A couple early season losses. They got hot. They were very tough to beat.
So you're saying Southern, your final top 10 team?
They went 6-5, man.
I said they got hot.
Well, you just said that they were hot. I mean, playing the best out of all college black college teams.
Holding on the offense, the penalty is declined, fourth down.
Let's take a look at our TiVo play of the game, and it's a mystery to me what it is, so let's roll it and see what it is. Oh, it's that big play for Grambling State, which gave them some cushion as Calvin Spears on the option play with the interception, taking it back 47 yards for a touchdown. That's our TiVo play of the game, brought to you by TiVo, TV your way.
TiVo.
So here we go with the
mystery kicker.
Mystery kicker, Lawrence Richmond, at a 10-yard punt, and this one doesn't look much better.
Kick goes out of bounds.
That punt good for 23 yards. It'll be first and 10, Alabama A&M at the 45. Back change. They've brought in their freshman, Chris Gunn, who has completed 52% of his passes.
And
on his first play, almost got
intercepted by Spears.
They're very high on Chris Gunn. You see his stats there, 69 completions on 131 attempts, 9 TDs, 5 interceptions. They feel this guy in the future is going to be a heck of a quarterback. Once they add about 40 pounds to his frame, I think he weighs about 150, 160 pounds. If he gets a little bigger, they think he's going to be a great player.
Now, is this the guy you spent all afternoon trying to help him with his mechanics? Because you remember that, right?
Right,
don't you, Newt?
Right.
Jay was out there working on mechanics with the young man.
I took the easy way out. Gunn's a lefty. I don't help lefties. I help the righties. I took the easy way out of that one. So he was not the guy I helped out.
Gunn's going to hold on to it. Gunn's going to try to make a run. Boy, he landed on top of his head.
Freshman mistake there.
But he picked up a couple of yards as we approach the 3.5-minute mark of this fourth and final quarter.
Great decision to run the football, but get down. You got to learn to get down, especially when you're playing against a defense that has all those hitters that Grambling has on there. You got to be careful about, you got to pick your spots, basically.
Yeah, he tried to jump up and bounce up, but he shook up. That's what happened.
He picked up 5 yards on that play. In the first meeting between these two teams, it was Gunn who was sacked 5 times. He was having a little problem in the backfield, decision making, but again, just a freshman. So here he is now on 3rd down and 5, rolling left. Ball was a little high. Pass was intended for Torrey Day. And he's throwing the football with 2 and 3 guys in the same vicinity. That's the second time I thought he was throwing to one guy and ended up having another guy behind him. I mean, it was too short for that guy. So here we go. Gunn looking deep on 4th down. Good coverage by the Grambling State Tigers. And that looked like that was Denmark Reed, one of the defenders back there.
I don't understand the move here with Coach Cooper. There's still 2:49 left in the game. He's just going on 4th down. I mean, I know he believes in his defense, but give him a chance. Punt the ball out and back him up. I mean, I'm getting a little too excited up here, but you know.
But your point is, I mean, you have the best defense in the conference. And so it's not like you're taking your chances. You're saying put the pressure on them to make the stop.
That's right.
Maybe he's hoping that they intercept those passes, but the Grambling defense is disciplined enough just to knock it down.
Yeah, okay. Not with a Scotty Anderson.
You aren't kidding, because Himes, despite the fact that they have the lead, is back in the shotgun, and he eludes the defense. And once you make a move past that initial wall, right, you get nice room, and he picked up about 5-6 yards on that play.
Good athlete. You know, he also caught a couple touchdown passes for him last year. And, you know, Doug says that this is a guy that could
300 yards, and it looks like he's going to try to add to that total. Or is he just going to run it? They want him to keep the ball on the ground. He makes a nice move to get by Ware.
That was a nice play by the left tackle, Frank Livingston, to let the guy rush inside so the quarterback can have a chance to break contain on the corner.
1:55 left, and now Alabama A&M is going to have to start thinking about what they're going to do. Looking at the timeout situation, it says on our scoreboard that A&M has just 1 timeout left, 3 timeouts left for Grambling State.
Grambling State offensive line has not had the best day. But going down the wire here, they seem to be pulling themselves together, keeping the guys off the quarterback, and just doing a nice job.
They've got to make the stop here. 3rd down now, and let's say 3. Himes up the middle. And a good play defensively by the Bulldogs. The man there to...
They've got some pressure on them before. Maybe they're just banking on a block kick right now.
So here we go. 7 seconds left on the clock. That's where they have to get the playoff. And here's Richmond. And Richmond this time says, let's do this for Maryland as he gets inside the 20. Good coverage for Grambling State. The first guy down there was Byron Brown. So here we go, folks. 1:05 left and an opportunity for Alabama A&M to try to tie this thing up. They're going to need 8 points to get it done, though.
All you have to do here is just move the chains with careful out routes, deep out routes, short out routes, get out of bounds, make things happen. Now, throwing it out of the backfield is not going to help. Going deep three plays in a row is not going to help unless you just get a all-out jailbreak going deep.
Keep in mind, if they get a first down, the right. clock will stop as right. they set the chains. So they don't have to...
Yes, right. But you necessarily just can't keep throwing it over the middle. Not with those great linebackers they got.
They got the freshman back there. Let's see how he handles the pressure. Chris Gunn throws. Caught. Good play by Dondra Holcomb. Holcomb gets out by the 39-yard line, and that'll be a first down. Clock stops with 57 seconds left. And the Bulldogs will quickly get the ball out. Ron Cooper taking his chances with a freshman. 21-yard pickup. Three receivers split to the right. Gunn has two to the left.
We got a new guy in the game. He's probably been in that. Brandon James is playing center.
Here he is again. This time it's Hamburg. Hamburg, showing some speed. Hamburg trying to get to the outside. And Calvin
fumble.
Calvin State has it.
Grambling State has won a great defensive effort on the last drive there. The defense kind of carried him for a while. The defense came up, made a great play there.
And with that, in this win, Doug Williams will be named the SWAC Coach of the Year
yeah.
in this conference. The winner of this game gets it. How about Doug, who came from Morehouse after going 3-8, and then in 1998 with Grambling was 5-6. In 99, team improved to 7-4, and in this year, 10-2 with this win. An absolutely unbelievable win for the Grambling State Tigers, and more importantly for Doug Williams. And quite frankly, folks, he's back where he belongs. This is the place he became an All-American. This is the place that made him one of the greatest quarterbacks in pro football history. And this is the place he's back, and he takes to a championship. More right now. Seen as the #1 team in all of black college football with the victory, and standing by with our own Joe Claire is the head coach, Doug Williams.
Hey, Coach, first of all, congratulations from everybody at BET. SWAC Championship, just tell the people, what do you want to say? How do you feel right now?
Well, basically, all I want to say, you know, I'm happy for the young guys, and I'm happy for myself and for Grambling State University. You know, ever since last year, the body class, when we had a chance to come to this game, I came to this game, I watched, and I said we should have been here, but we'll be here next year. We came, and we won, and that's what it's all about.
All right, now, I had a lot of your players, I've seen them throughout the season. They said, you're going to see us, Joe. You're going to see us at the championship. I was like, all right, I'm going to see you. You showed up today. Wonderful job. What's next?
Well, all I want to say for all the people in them polls who play, hey, Grambling's #1 in the SWAC. I want you to know that. And we'll be back. We young. We're going to bring a nucleus back next year, and we want to get back here next year.
All right, Coach. Thanks a lot. Congratulations again. Take it easy. Go enjoy yourself. Back up to y'all upstairs, man. Back up to y'all. I'm a professional. Back up to y'all upstairs.
All right, thank you very much, Joe. So once again, good win for Grambling State as they are the champions of the SWAC. We also, though, have to congratulate Alabama A&M on their season. An absolutely tremendous year for them. They had to come into the final week of the regular season and get a win over Arkansas Pine Bluff. And with the victory over Pine Bluff, that got them into this championship game. So a gutsy performance for Ron Cooper and his club. And you got the feeling that they're also going to be back. They've got some young players. Chris Gunn will be back at the quarterback spot. And that should help this team out offensively. We already know what they can do defensively. Let's first start off with you, Jay, and talk about Doug Williams and the job that he's done with this offense in terms of making them better.